Last time we played, Johan and Sirkesh decided that being a guard sounds pretty good, so they went to go be guards and clean latrines, and Johan decided to start drinking. Perrin wanted to initially join the witchery, and after Sirkesh kind of overzealously put him to the task, decided maybe it's not for him. Went off to be see if he could be a doctor. Or some such thing. Vel did her first day as a maester's apprentice. Listened to a trade deal, had a whole lot of fun with that. And Halasia decided that she liked to use magic again. So she went to the Archmage, or not the Archmage, the High Mage, to see if she could get into the Mage's College and or become a botanist or herbalist for him. Was given a small stick and the order make it grow. Went outside, did some voodoo witchcraft on it, and nearly engulfed the entire town in evil mutant tendril vines. The entire party came to her aid, and the threat was dealt with in the courtyard of the palace. She apologized and then decided to go and sit outside of the High Mage's door all night. And when we left off, the rest of you had all congregated back at the inn. So yeah, Sirkesh, Johan, and Perrin, you're three together, and Hale is just kind of hanging out outside the Archmage's store. You guys go ahead and take it away.
What time is it roughly?
It's night. It's like dinner time, so it's probably like 6 or 7.
Okay. I'm gonna make my way back downstairs from my room.
Okay. Your both of your rooms are on the bottom floor.
Oh, they are? Okay.
Yeah.
I thought you said that she had led us up one flight of stairs.
Nope.
Okay.
She led you down one hallway. And you were the last
then
room
I'll
on the
just
left.
Make my way to the reception desk or
okay.
Communal area.
You make your way over there, and the man that was playing bartender for you last night is kind of in that area, just kind of getting dinner ready for all the inn guests, separately from the tavern guests on the opposite side, and welcomes you as you enter.
Okay. I didn't ask last week, but the man who was playing bartender, who is the owner of the inn.
Yes.
Does he look like he has any elf in him, or is it just his daughter?
No, he just looks like a human.
Okay. Then, yeah, I approach him. Is he busy, or is he...
He's not particularly busy. He's basically just... It looks like he's essentially, like, preparing the ingredients to put into the meals and stuff.
Okay. Pardon me, sir.
Yeah, oh, hello. What can I do for you?
It would appear as though I'm going to be staying at your inn for a while, and I was hoping to re-up my payment for the room I'm staying in this evening, as I only paid for last night's.
Yes, of course.
I hand him 5 silver.
Okay.
And,
Thank you very much. Will you be joining us for dinner?
Yes. How long until?
Should be no more than a half an hour.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I shall see you then. Bye. If he has nothing else to say, I'm going to make my way back up to the room.
Yeah, he just kind of goes back to preparing the meals and such. You do notice, though, that someone's put up tinsel and ornaments all around the kind of common area of the tavern in celebration of the festival it seems to be building up as you come in. And you head back to your room.
Okay.
Anyone else have anything they want to do while Richard opens up his 15,000 different notes he has to?
Have we rested since the events of last week?
No. You just went.
No, it's evening.
You're back at your hotel, but no one's gone to bed or anything yet.
Okay. I guess probably go eat something. Yeah, let's go do that. So I guess I'll go down to the bar and get some food.
Okay. You head into the bar. It's packed. Also kind of like the inn. There seems to be a bit of a festive atmosphere going on. There's this really kind of nice white tinseling that outlines the entirety of the top of the bar with some kind of nice florally colored ornaments placed all about, and a couple of statues to the gods that you haven't seen before placed about the room. You find a seat at the bar, and the slightly elvish looking girl approaches. Yes, what can I do for you?
I was just looking for a simple meal to end my day.
Would you like a meat pie or a salad, sir?
I don't think Aaron's ever had a meat pie. So I guess, I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with a meat pie, you said? What is this?
It's a pastry that's filled with beef and onion and leek, and it's baked, and it's quite tender and delicious.
Never tried one before. I think I'll have one of those.
Excellent. And is there any beverage you would like?
I best not drink, just some simple water, I suppose.
Very well. And she turns and kind of heads back in towards the kitchen area, which is cordoned off by some drapery. After a few minutes, she returns with essentially a pint of water and the pie that she sets in front of you, placing some cutlery down as well. That will be 2 silver pieces.
Let's see. I guess I'll, because I only have gold at the moment, I'll take out one of my gold coins to go, you have change.
She nods and then kind of walks back into the kitchen and comes out and slides over 8 silver pieces for the gold. And then she thanks you, asks if there's anything else she can do for you.
No, that'll be all for now. Thank you.
Okay. She goes and starts tending to some of the other guests along the bar. So, Kesh, what are you up to?
I'm gonna go and ask for a small loaf of bread and to fill my water sack. I'm gonna head to the witchery and continue my research.
Okay. Yeah, as soon as you kind of walk down the hall and enter the main, like, lobby area, there's bread that's kind of just set out, and you take a slice or you take a loaf, essentially. Fill up your water from some of the well water and head down to the witchery. Are you going to continue your research?
I'm first going to speak to Lady Rocha.
Okay. You get to the witchery, which is very obvious that it's not decorated at all. There's, like, no fanciful anything going on here. They don't seem to be partaking in any of the festivities. You enter and ask for Lady Rocha, and you are told that she's not currently in. But if you would like to leave a message with them, they'll get it to her.
Oh, that'll be fine. Is my gnome teacher here?
I'll have to go and look around, and she turns and kind of heads towards the back area, returning in a few minutes. I don't believe so. I don't see her anywhere in the quarters.
Oh, that's quite all right. I'm going to go down to the basement and continue my research. I'll bring up whatever the findings I find.
She's about to say very good as your spear enters her throat, and she begins choking on blood. Your fucking
Wait, what?
Spear roll.
Oh no, my keyboard started wigging out.
Yeah, she says it's okay, and then you head down. Go ahead and give me an intelligence check, or an investigation check for research. Okay. You
Moderate.
Don't, yeah, you don't really find anything that seems like it's going to be of any use. You continue to... You essentially have decided to focus your research on learning the geography of the area to the north of Deadwood. You don't think that it's going to be that much of a help to the rest of the witchery, but it could come in handy for you at some point in time. And you basically just spend a couple of hours looking through... tales and maps of the Black Mountain and Misthaven.
Well, after I finish a few hours, I'm going to head back to the barracks, and that's where I'm going to stay.
Okay. You head back to the barracks, and you get a couple of odd looks as you kind of just take a bed. No one really says anything to you, or bothers you as you kind of settle in for the night. Johan, Perrin?
After about 30 minutes, I'm going to make my way down for dinner.
Okay. You're offered either salad, meat pie, and mead if you would like it.
Is it the owner or his daughter?
The owner's still at the inn, apparently.
Okay. I'm going to take a salad.
Okay. He basically prepares it, like, right in front of you, and... ask if you would like anything to drink.
I'll take a water, but that brings me to something I'd like to ask you. If I'm to stay here for an extended period of time, would it be possible to pay you a bit extra over the cost of my room so that you could have some tea stocked for me?
Tea? Yes, of course, if that's what you would like.
I'd be most grateful if you could.
Is there any kind of tea that you particularly enjoy?
Earl Grey or Earl Grey or chamomile, if you have it. Otherwise, I'll take anything you have.
We don't have any at the moment, but when I send my daughter out shopping, I'll have her go look for that.
Thank you kindly.
He nods and then fills up.
Feel free to just add it to my room tab.
Fills up a glass of water and hands it to you, for you to enjoy your meal. I heard that there was something that happened at the palace today. Some strange tree or something?
Unfortunately, I don't have very many details. I showed up towards the end, but... some plant's growth was out of control, and it threatened to envelop, at the very least, the courtyard. Some soldiers were injured, but... tended to by Perrin's still sitting at the bar, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Okay. So I point to Perrin. They were tended to by
Well, you're in the inn
Perrin.
Right now.
Oh, I'm at the inn?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize they were okay.
They're separate areas.
Okay. Then never mind. Tended to by my companion who's also staying at this inn. So fortunately there were no casualties or grievous injuries.
That is quite lucky.
But beyond that, I can't offer you any information. Other than, it seems to have been caused by someone's carelessness.
He nods, kind of like looking off into the distance for a second, and quickly current turns back to you. Oh, is your last name Koenig?
It is.
We received a letter for you, and he goes to the front desk area and comes back with a sealed letter. It's quite nice parchment sealed with a deep white wax with a crest you've never seen before. This was given to us this afternoon for you.
Oh. Thank you, sir. Much appreciated. As long as I've got you here, if it's not too much trouble, would you be able to recommend a popular or talented smith in town? Or does that go outside of your realm of knowledge?
I know for a fact that I wrote down who the smith in the town is, but I can't fucking find it. Oh.
If he doesn't know, don't worry. I'm we'll just ask Critical later.
Yeah. That would be O'Reilly down at the Iron Arms off of Main Street. If you go down the main street and then you take a right and you head towards the main square, just before you hit the square on the left-hand side of the street, you'll find it.
Once more, I'm greatly appreciative of your assistance.
O'Reilly at the Iron Arms?
Hmm? What?
You asked me once more. You wanted to know his name?
No. Did I lag out? I said, once more, I'm greatly appreciative of your services.
I know.
Oh. Oh, got it. He misunderstood. Mm-hmm. Not lag. Sorry, you were lagging for me, so...
Good. Skype's fun.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Look at that.
Yes, and he goes back to dealing with his other customers. The other people at the inn. You enjoy your meal. Perrin, you also enjoy your meal and eventually finish it up.
Okay.
Hale. Someone goes to the... it appears another servant or someone kind of like goes to the mage's door and is about to knock, and then the door just kind of vanishes in front of them. They walk in, and then the door just seals up behind them. And, yeah, you just kind of sit out there with your flower. So, Perrin, Johan, is there anything that you guys would like to do?
No, I think it's been a long day, so I'm gonna go to the room and sleep.
Okay.
I'm gonna head up to the room and read my letter.
Okay. Your letter is essentially just a letter from Regent Prince Virgil Mikelic, and it is granting you your request with to have audience with him 2 days after the new year during lunch at the palace.
I know you have the date here we go. Oh, no, I guess I don't see it on there.
It's 3 days from now.
Okay. 3 days from now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, I'll put it back in the envelope, and I can't reseal it, but I will, you know, close it. Yeah.
Okay. Perrin's just kind of sitting. Veltari's in there, and she's already fast asleep. It appears her day was quite stressful in one of the beds. Johan, I assume you take the other bed?
Yeah, and also, before I go to sleep, she's not really here to say yes or no, but can I borrow a piece of Vel's parchment and her quill?
I'm gonna say all right, and I'm gonna...
I'll leave her, like, 2 silver if need be.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know what? No, I paid for her fucking room tonight. She owes me paper.
Okay. Yeah, you can borrow her quill, and... Yes. so whatever you want to do, go ahead.
Oh, I just is that Roger?
Who the fuck is raping their mic?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Alright. I was also curious as to what that was.
Yeah, that's a Roger.
Yep. Anyways, what are you doing, Zach?
What are you doing, sharpening a knife?
I'm jotting down notes and, like, a rough sketch of, the Jiang to take to the smith.
Okay. Sounds good. And then you pack in for the night as well?
Yeah.
Alright, so, next day, so Kesh, you're already at the barracks, so you essentially get ready and then head off to work, I assume?
I go to the mess hall and get breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
Then I'll get to work, whatever they put me on this time.
Okay.
Is breakfast served that early at the inn, or would I have to grab it at the mess hall?
There's essentially, like, breads and stuff that are left out for any of the really early risers, but no, the normal breakfast isn't served yet.
That's fine. I'll grab a piece of bread and some water before I head out. Okay. Also, unlike yesterday, I do take my quarterstaff with me today.
Alright. Perrin, what do you do?
I guess just as a daily thing, since I only sleep 4 hours a day, I'll just make it a daily habit to just go get some of the bread so I eat something in the morning.
Okay.
And then, otherwise, I don't remember what time I was supposed to show up at the hospital.
Good.
I think I was told noon. I don't remember. I'll make my way there anyway.
Okay. Sounds good. So Kesh, you and Johan are told that you are going to be watching over the festival today.
There's a festival?
There is a festival. Didn't, I mean...
He was at the inn last night, right? Even he didn't sleep there.
For like 2 moments.
Yeah, he went there, assuming he got his stuff. Grab and then stuff, left.
Yeah.
Oh, I kept my gear on me through the day.
Yeah, so he showed up, got food, and then left.
In that case, didn't you notice all of the decorations back
at
the inn?
Yeah, I didn't realize it was going to be this soon. I was going to ask about it yesterday, but I forgot.
All right.
So, what are we doing on the guarding duty for the festival?
You're told that you're essentially just to walk around and make sure that no belligerence or disturbing of the peace happens in the town square during the festival until nightfall, at which point you're off duty and you can do whatever you would like.
Okay, then. I'm heading down there as we speak.
We were given our uniforms yesterday, right? Because that's why we had to show up so early. Okay.
Yeah, you didn't have to show up quite as early today.
All right. I just want to make sure that I actually had mine.
Mm-hmm. Perrin, you make your way to, I believe it's the Lady of Mercy Hospital.
Yep. Have that in my notes.
Our Lady of Mercy Hospital. And as you enter, you also make note that there seems to be, not that you didn't see them yesterday, but all of the small statues and honorifics to all the deities seem to have been, like, polished up, and you can see small offerings sometimes left at the base of them. Just either little trinkets or, like, pieces of bread and that kind of stuff. You walk over to the emergency ward and immediately hear, "Ah, you're early! Great! I could use your help right now!" As the gnomish woman jumps over and grabs you by the hand and begins leading you towards the back of the room. She opens up a small partition And in a bed, you see someone with a very kind of deep gash that's just cutting across the top of their chest. They said he had some trouble with some horses, so I'll sew it up, and then you you just slap your heel over him, and we'll be fine, yeah?
Sounds good.
And you see her pull out a needle and thread and very quickly go to work, sewing the wound shut as much as possible. And then once she's done with that, she asks you to finish, and then as you're just stepping up to heal, she's already out of the room and on to the next. And you can hear her yelling as she closes the partition. And don't take too long. I'll need your help in a minute.
Okay. So, how do we want to do these? I'm just going to expend a spell slot every time we do this, or...
Yeah, essentially, unless you're doing Spare the Dying, just start ticking down spell slots. And essentially, over the course of the day, you're going to pretty much consistently lose all of your spell slots except for one.
Okay.
And yeah, you go about following her, and go ahead and roll medicine for me.
Just straight, or?
Yeah, just a straight roll. Okay. Yeah. Occasionally she has you set bone or stitch up some of the less critical cases, and you do an all right job of it. Occasionally she has to take over. You're not used to setting bone by hand yet. And you kind of make a couple mistakes the first time you try, but she's there to fix it, and you go about most of your day in that fashion. You get the distinct feeling that even though she's a little bit harsh on you, that overall she just wants to get her job done. Towards the end of the day for you, you also see Fersa come in and kind of begin taking over from what you were doing. And she goes over to you, basically, towards the end of your shift. So are you going to go to the festival today? Or are you just going to head back home after you're done?
I am not familiar with this custom, so I might explore a bit. Not terribly sure what all happens during such festivities.
Oh, this is your first Selenmus?
Yes.
Well, it's a communal gathering. In prayer, or in essence, in prayer to Selene, it's supposed to be to wash out the old year and pray for good fortune and good harvest in the next year. It's quite a sight. Most of the shopkeepers and store owners bring stuff outside, and there's a lot of charity given to the poor. Free drink and food are abundant. And I've heard it's quite popular for some people to go to diviners and soothsayers to see what fortunes the new year will bring for them.
So it might be an opportunity for me to do a little good. That's always nice to know.
Yes, you could always work, if you would like to do some charity work. Almost all of the temples have soup kitchens and alike out on the streets, or getting donations to help the poor.
I'll keep that in mind.
Excellent. How did you like your first day?
It's not too bad. It's takes a little getting used to, but definitely expect to learn a lot while I'm here.
Yes, I hope you... Fersa! Get to work! We got stuff to do! Come on! And with that, she kind of just rolls her eyes and then gives a very kind of short bow and heads to the back of the hospital.
Yeah.
That's about right. Hale, at about noon, the door finally just opens, and there's no one around, it's just you. And there's just a rush of very hot, almost steam-like air rushes out and hits you, and you realize that you've been sitting here all night, and it's kind of drafty out here.
Okay, well, I'm gonna take a quick look around and step inside.
The second you step inside, the door behind you shuts magically. And you can see the High Mage, again, sitting behind his desk, flicking through a large leather-bound tome. So, did you complete your task?
I present him with the flower and some of the vines that I saved from it, and inform him of the events from the previous day.
Ah, yes. I had to work out, well, some dealings with the Lord to make sure you didn't get in any trouble for that. But you seem to have done an adequate job. And he kind of holds up the flower and begins looking at it. And then sets it down on his desk. So, what is it that you would like?
I just came looking for a purpose while we're staying here for the rest of our time.
You wanted to be granted admittance to the Mage's College?
If at all possible, yes.
And we are in dire need of a herbologist, though... Well, you're assertive, and I like that. Well, I suppose you can work for me, and your dues will go to paying off your admittance to the Mage's College. I will allow you to work with one of my assistants to train you and make sure you know all of the rules and our laws. Does that sound fair?
That sounds more than fair. Thank you, sir.
Very good. And you can start, and he turns and he gives a very sharp whistle and a slow, very large amphibious creature that you've never seen before with this giant domed shell and this very kind of cute small little head on the front of it slowly marches out from behind another partition with a massive black and green leather-bound book that has like tufts of maybe fur that wasn't shaved off of the animal completely before the tome was made. And it slowly kind of marches towards you and then stops about a foot away from the High Mage, and he stands up. You can start by reading this. I will need you to grow some black thistle, which we have in the back, and you can start, well, you should be able to read this in a week, yeah? And he kind of smacks the tome, and it's quite a daunting task.
I will do my best.
Very good. Where are you staying?
I don't have a particular place. I tend to just stay outside where the sun's warmest.
Ah, excellent. And he reaches into his robes and pulls out a small brass key and hands it to you. I suppose it'll be easiest if you stay at the greenhouse.
That would be wonderful, thank you.
No, my lady, thank you.
Is that all?
Yes, when I find a suitable master for you, I will send them and you will begin your training. Until then, you should read up before you get started, so we don't have any more incidents like yesterday.
Yes, sir. I'm gonna grab the book and show my way out and thank him again.
Okay. You grab the book, and as you kind of move to lift it off of the very large tortoise, you lift it up, and go ahead and make an athletics check for me. You attempt to hoist it, and as you essentially let it slide off, you realize that it probably weighs a good 40 or 50 pounds. And it just slides to the floor with a thud.
Sir, is there any possible easier way to transport this book from one place to another? It's quite heavy.
Oh, you're a clever girl. I'm sure you'll think of some way. And he kind of pats the tortoise on the head.
May I borrow your creature?
I suppose. And he leans down and whispers something to it. And then looks at you.
I'm gonna work my way to get the book back onto the tortoise and have it follow me out.
Okay, go ahead and roll athletics.
Oh!
Wow. That is the opposite of the gods favoring you.
That's a double one.
Special. Wow.
So as I decide how I want to deal with this, Johann and Sirkesh.
Yes!
I'm not rolling double ones, so... I'm having a better time.
You guys go about, and you go down into the town square, and in the town square, you can already see people, shopkeepers, grocers, pretty much everybody who runs any kind of establishment, inns, taverns, everything. You can see them all kind of congregating just out front, bringing like stools, tables, some chairs, and essentially there are feast upon feast of fine cooking happening. There are large hogs put on spits that are being honey marinated as they roast. Ales are being poured already, even though it's the morning. You notice that a lot of the east side poor have kind of come to the city center. Families already are going from shop to shop, buying presents and gifts and partaking. And you kind of just begin wandering through. Both of you go ahead and make a perception test.
Wow.
You were saying?
I was incorrect, but it wasn't two.
We don't know that. So, as you're kind of walking by, Johann, you are particularly drawn in by the delicious smell of one of the nearby roasts going on. And you trip over a small child and fall to the ground. Sirkesh immediately notices and pulls you up, and then you guys kind of just go about your day after apologizing.
Before I continue on, apologize to the child, I hand them 5 copper pieces and tell them to enjoy the festival.
He looks up at you with a pretty large smile on his face and thanks you, and then goes and kind of catches up to people who you believe to be his guardian. You guys just kind of mosey about from place to place, helping out any like shopkeeper that, you know, needs extra eyes or, you know, anything like that as the day progresses.
Okay.
Halasia, you begin kind of pushing the book up the tortoise, and you get it precariously teetered on the front of it, or on the top, and you kind of let it go, see if it balances, and it seems like it's balancing. That's good. And then you basically, you know, point to the tortoise to go, and with its first lurching step, you see the shift of the giant tome jut forward, and oh wow, that was pretty lucky. Ba-ba-ba-bum. It smacks into the back of the tortoise's head and plants it pretty firmly in the ground before sliding off of the shell and landing with a thud on the floor next to it. At that, the high mage just stands upright, looking first at his pet and then at you, before sighing, seeing that the pet wasn't injured too much, and then sits back down. You can hear under his breath, "You're gonna have to be more clever than that." I'm not sure if they're both muted on purpose or on accident.
Oh, mine's pushed to talk, sorry.
So, Hale, what do you do?
First thing I'm going to do is do cure wounds on the tortoise, because I feel bad for it.
Okay. You lean down next to it, and light radiance emanates from your hand, and you can see the kind of crink in its neck straighten out, and it looks about as good as it was before. It didn't seem like it took much damage from the book falling on its head.
Are there any items nearby with, like, wheels or anything? Maybe a wheelbarrow or something in the greenhouse?
Oh, yeah, in the greenhouse, if you walk all the way to the greenhouse, and when you unlock it, yeah, there's kind of simple gardening tools, shears, hoe, rake, there's a wheelbarrow, a bucket.
Okay, I'm going to borrow the wheelbarrow, bring it all the way back, and then I'm going to use guidance and try to put the book in the wheelbarrow.
Okay. What does guidance do again?
You touch one willing creature once before the spell ends. The target can roll a d4 and add to the number rolled to one ability check of its choice. It can roll the die before or after making the ability check, then the spell ends.
What are you using guidance on? Because the book is not a creature.
Oh. I'm using it for my acrobatics ability check. Because I know it's coming.
Yeah, it doesn't say it can't be used on yourself.
Okay.
So.
Go ahead and roll athletics. And add your d4 to it. Alright. You touch yourself and, giggity, and immediately you can feel your bark, shell kind of dense, or densen, that's a word, and you grab the tome, and with all of your might, you quite easily, actually, lift it and set it in the wheelbarrow. And you turn to head out, and you can hear behind you the High Mage say, "You know, that's at least 3 times now that you've committed an executable offense. I'm gonna hope that you use more discretion in the future."
"Thank you, sir. Sorry, sir."
And he kind of nods as you leave the room and head back to the back to the greenhouse. And you begin your joyous day of reading. Not too long after you get back to the greenhouse, you see Veltari, who comes out to see you as she's getting a break for her lunch and decided to go and visit with you since you're nearby. You both sit and chat. She asks you about the turtle. It was a cute turtle. Pretty old, but it's a pretty cool turtle. And yeah. She asks if you're going to go to the festival tonight or if you're just going to stay in the greenhouse essentially all day.
"I have to read, so I'm going to actually stay here and read. The festival holds no interest for me anyways."
She nods, and after you mention that you have to read all day, she kind of looks around and notices the giant tome sitting in the wheelbarrow, and you swear that you could almost see her eyes salivating.
"Would you like to read it with me? You're more than welcome to help me take notes."
Unfortunately, she doesn't have the time. She has to get back to her job, but at some point she would like to read it.
"Okay. I'm gonna bid her farewell and read."
Okay. Sarkesh Johan, it is now fairly late in the afternoon, and Perrin, you begin kind of wandering out. You're done for your day's work. And you can see Sarkesh and Johan wandering from place to place in the town square as you go about, or as you leave Our Lady of Mercy.
Okay. I think actually I'm going to walk in because I need to ask Gillette something.
Okay.
Gillette up.
You find Jeanette. "Yeah, what do you want? What do you need? Did you forget something? Did you lose something?"
"Yeah, I forgot to ask, is this a position that pays, or..."
"Yes, of course. I pay at the end of the week, like everyone. Why, do you need money now?"
"No, I was just making sure."
"Yeah. 2 gold a day. If you're good. We'll see."
"Well, certainly hope I live up to your expectations."
"You did all right today. Keep it up."
"Good to know. I'll let you get back to your work then."
She nods and then heads off, and again, just as soon as you see her kind of like duck behind a partition, you just hear the shrill yell of, "Fursa, come on!" And with a oddly optimistic look, you just see kind of Fursa just wandering behind her.
"I feel like Perrin should get some of that."
"Go for it, bro."
"Let's see. Anyway, gonna go ahead and walk back outside then."
Okay. Again, you're hit by the smells of everything. It smells delicious. It smells like you're in a giant bake-off of just food and ale and wine, fruits, meats, honeys. It's It's quite impressive. Now that it's later in the day, even more families are kind of congregating outside, as it seems people are kind of getting off of their jobs and are just kind of relaxing, going about. You notice people giving each other gifts, and some people just kind of like wandering and striking up casual conversation. It's more alive than you've seen the town since you came here. And it's quite pleasant. It's a nice atmosphere.
Yeah. I think I'll work my way towards the Shrine of Velka.
Okay.
See if I can help the Shrine Maiden.
Yeah. You make your way to the Shrine of Velka, and the Maiden is outside, and she's pouring a seemingly homeless person, a nice bowl of soup, and notices you as you approach. Ah, yes. You're that cleric that helped me, aren't you?
Yes. And I see that the town is quite busy, and I hear that, especially for this time of year, that you the shrines are a bit more busier, and was wondering if you needed help today.
Well, if you would like to help me, I've been passing out soup all day. You could go and help cook some more. If you've got any skill, or you can do this and I'll go and make some more.
Cooking is survival?
It's survival or intelligence based on the type of cooking you're doing.
Okay. I'm probably better at finding food, but I mean, I wouldn't mind trying to help cook or serve it.
Alright, well, if you go back to the end of the shrine, there's a small door on the left, and that's where the kitchen is.
Okay. Well, let's see what I can do.
Okay. You walk through the shrine, and there's a number of people within the shrine eating and talking with each other. And you make your way to the back, and it's a very small, quaint little kitchen it's packed today with what appears to be completely gorgeous fresh produce, tomato, berries, meat that you're not too familiar with, water, spices, and you kind of find a knife, and if you would like to, go ahead and make a survival roll, or an intelligence roll, whichever one you prefer.
I'm gonna go with survival.
Okay.
I like that.
You make a very delicious and hearty stew that you've made before. You take the meat, and it doesn't really matter what kind of meat it is. You just set it in some boiling water. You find some spices that you're familiar with. Throw it together with some of the vegetables and fruits that you found. And you taste it, and it is delicious. It's a very hearty meal, but it's very well balanced. And you kind of bring out a small cauldron full to the front and hand it to the Shrine Maiden, who tastes it and, oh my, you are fantastic. Are you a chef?
No. It's just a simple recipe, I know.
Well, it's amazing. Perhaps you should get into the culinary careers.
I'll certainly consider that, but I feel my place is more suited towards healing people.
Yes, well, I can't argue with that. Please, if you wouldn't mind making more, I'm sure everyone will love it.
I'll do just that.
And, yeah, with that, you kind of wander into the back and begin cooking again. Keep doing that for however long you feel like it, making batch after batch.
keep doing it until it's about, like, dusk, I guess.
Okay. Johan, Sirkesh, is there anything that you guys like to do?
Is our shift over now?
It's getting towards the end of the shift.
I'll take one more sweep around the area, and then I'll head back to end the shift.
Okay. Johan?
If I see any... either, like, unaccompanied or just, like, downtrodden children, I'll hand out copper to them as well so they can enjoy the festival.
Okay.
But other than that, no, I'm just making my rounds.
Alright. Go ahead and... Well, actually, you don't have to roll perception. There's a couple of, beggar children, about on the street.
Okay.
So, we'll say there's, like, probably about six or so that you come across, as you're going about your last patrol.
I hand out 3 to 5 copper to each of them, so however much you want to...
Look, go ahead and just mark out whatever you're doing, because you're the one giving it away.
Okay. In that case, I'll just mark out, like, 20 copper that's been distributed amongst...
Yeah, they're all very grateful to you as, when you give them copper. Their faces light up.
Okay. Other than that, no, I'm just completing my day.
Okay. You guys make your final rounds, and you both kind of note that this town doesn't seem lawless, or it seems well in hand. Like, there are very few situations that ever seem to escalate. You hear some of the other guards occasionally. As you got back to the barracks, you hear some of the other guards who had to deal with kind of drunken belligerents, but no one who was committing any harder crimes like theft or anything. And yeah, you come to a close in your shift and you're now free to do whatever you'd like.
I'll head back and see what I can do at the witchery. Grabbing a little food on the way.
Okay. You grab some of the meal from the galley.
Yeah.
And then head over to the witchery. Go ahead and roll investigation. As you do. Oh, what was the message that you wanted to send to Lady Rocha?
I was just wanting to speak to her.
Okay. As you get there, the sister goes to the back, and not long after that, Lady Rocha comes out. You wanted to speak with me, Paladin?
Yes, I was wondering if you needed any more assistance from me. I'd like anything other to do during the night time before I have to go sleep.
Well, at the moment, research is our most important avenue. Soon we'll be sending out small parties into the mountains to try and find any clue of where these necromancers seem to be hiding.
Also, why did none of your people partake in the festivities? I just thought it a little strange.
Well, some of them do, of course. You can see them out on the street if you look hard enough, but we like to keep everything a bit more professional while you're here. So,
I do understand.
The witchery doesn't participate, but we don't hold anyone back from their personal beliefs or worships.
I understand. If you need me, I'll be in the basement.
Very good. Let me know if you find anything.
Yes, ma'am.
And she, gives you a polite bow before leaving.
I nod and head to the basement.
Oh, yeah. Alright, Johan, what are you up to?
I'm making my way to O'Reilly's.
Okay. You make your way, and, it's pretty easy to find. It's one of the larger, storefronts just outside of the city center, and as you were doing your patrols, you noticed it, and you find your way...
The innkeeper gave me pretty good direction.
You find your way to, I don't know why I can't find it. It's the iron something. Iron Arms. You find your way to Iron Arms, and you see a very tall, middle-aged man wearing a welder's or a blacksmith's smock and apron. And he's speaking to a significantly younger looking female who's also wearing kind of that sort of class of clothing. As you approach them, they're essentially trying to figure out what mead they should be setting out for the festival. The man doesn't seem that keen on celebrating, but the girl seems quite adamant about doing something.
Real quick, what was the name of the inn I was staying at? For the life of me, it keeps escaping. I'm gonna write it down this time.
It is... Ba-ba-ba-bum.
It's like Ock something.
Arcturus Inn.
Arcturus, okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
So they're just talking, essentially?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then I will make my way up, and if I'm not noticed as I approach, I'll make myself known.
No, as you even remotely begin to get close, the rather tall and stout dwarvish man turns to you. Ah, customer, excellent. Yeah, Penelope, just go in and grab some of the cheap mead and bring it out here if you're so keen on celebrating festivities. What can I do for you, sir?
Yes, I come to you on recommendation of the owner of the Arcturus Inn. He says you are a skilled smith in town.
Ah, Felivon. Yes, I don't think it's too hard to... Or it's too much of an overstatement to say that I am the best smith in the town. Smith of the city guard and the nobles alike.
Kind of an internal eye roll, but Johan does make note of the arrogance.
Okay.
Well, that's most splendid, as I would like to hire you for a custom job.
Ah, what can I do for you? Some steel you need?
Indeed. I was hoping, and I pull out the notes that I'd scribbled the night before with, diagram and description.
Mm-hmm.
I was hoping for a slightly unusual short sword. Not much, or not found much in these parts, but back west, far more popular. And I kind of hand it over to him.
He snatches it out of your hand and looks at it. This
should be simple enough.
Yes,
especially for the best blacksmith in town.
Yes, it'd be quite simple. But why would you want such a thin blade? Wouldn't you want a more stout thrust?
Sorry, I'm just looking at something real quick. No, I find this blade is far easier to wield, and its quick movements suit my style.
Very well, I'll I'll get this done for you.
Excellent. How much will it cost? I can pay in advance. I'll be here a while.
Ah, you can pay in advance. Excellent. Let's see, a custom job of this, and it needs to be flexible steel. 12 gold and I'll get it done for you in 3 days.
You needn't rush it, but the speed is much appreciated.
Of course. It's a small bit of steel.
I pull out my satchel and pull out 12 gold pieces.
He takes it and, your name, please, sir.
Johann Koenig. If I haven't returned in 3 days at its completion, I can be found at the Arcturus Inn, and you can send word for me, but I should be back.
Excellent, excellent. Well then, pleasure doing business with you, Mr. Koenig.
Likewise.
Puts out his hand.
I meet his hand.
Well, at this moment, the girl comes back out with some mead. Ah, would you like to have some mead, perhaps?
No, thank you. I don't drink.
Very well. I'll have this done for you 3 days.
Thank you. I shall return then.
And he goes to...
Enjoy the festivities.
Ah, and you as well.
I bow and make my way back out.
Okay. Parents? Dusk.
Yeah. I go to the Shrine Maiden and tell her that I'm gonna partake in the festivities for a little bit.
She tells you to have some fun, and thanks you profusely for the fine soup that you made for all the begotten and lost people of Deadwood.
Course. I'll give her a good bow and then start walking around.
Okay. You make your way downtown and see Johann talking with this dwarvish man who appears to run an armory. And yeah, there's a bunch of people, families walking the streets. There's drinking, merriment, occasionally people just kind of bursting out in song or prayer on the streets. Torches are being lit, and you can see that at least one of the other temples is essentially like leading a mass prayer that you can hear from a couple of blocks over.
Okay. Well, I guess I'm going to venture towards where I see the most amount of people.
Okay. So yeah, you head to the town square. There's actually, as you get there, games, a small tournament, and other festivities going on, along with the just general food that's quite abundant and such. This is where it seems most people are congregating.
Okay. I'll kind of just spend some time walking around and just taking the sights in the...
Okay. Johann, as you finish up your conversation, what do you want to do?
I suppose I'll make my way back to the inn for dinner.
Okay. You make your way back to the inn. The daughter greets you and brings you out your food.
Okay. Is it busy at the inn right now, or are most people out eating?
Yeah, most people are out. The inn's fairly vacant at the moment.
Okay. Is she not busy enough that I can like strike up a conversation?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems, okay. As you get to the inn, you can see her father is outside, handing out some mead and stuff and kind of making conversation with, people in the street and alley area nearby. As you get in, she seems to be the one that's actually tending to the inn, and it's almost completely vacant. There's a couple of people who are just kind of, like, sitting around in the common room, and she doesn't seem busy at all.
Okay. So she's already brought me my food, or I'm coming in and we're busy? Okay.
Yeah.
In that case, pardon me, young lady, would you mind if I ask a couple questions?
Sure. What do you need?
I was hoping you could explain the meaning of the festivities to me. I notice the decorations and quite a few shops putting stuff out for it, but as an outsider, I don't actually know the purpose of such a festival.
You don't celebrate Salinas where you come from?
I would imagine not in our, right?
Just say yes or no.
This
is on you, buddy. Okay.
Okay.
Anytime I ask you a question that you don't know the answer to, just make it up and go with it.
Okay.
Got your back, bro. It's a celebration of the end of the year and hopes for a good new year. It's in worship to the goddess Selene, and it's about charity and good works.
An honorable holiday.
She nods.
Seems like the kind of thing that should be celebrated. I'm just going to stick with everywhere.
Yes, I've never been out of Deadwood, but I assumed that it was all across the Empire. Strange that it isn't.
Well, Deadwood seems like a much more tight-knit city than elsewhere, so it would make sense that they would have such a holiday.
I suppose that's nice to hear.
Well, all the same, I spoke to your father yesterday, and I will be staying here for the duration of my time in Deadwood, so reach out my hand. My name's Johan, and it's a pleasure to meet you.
Lucilia, and she takes her hand, and very kind of, like, loosely or gently squeezes it.
Okay. Thank you for the meal and the information. I hope you have a pleasant evening.
You too.
And with that, I begin eating.
She stands there, kind of looking at you for a couple of seconds, and then turns and leaves after you begin eating.
Okay.
Yeah, Perrin, you wander about and you kind of watch. There's eating contests going on, and a wooden sword fighting tournament seems to be taking place. As well as just kind of interesting entertainers all around, from fire eaters to people doing feats of strength and dexterity and derring do.
I'd be inclined to try any of these. I might, like, are these things that are, like, all these contests still kind of open, or are they kind of, like, closed at this point?
No, they all seem like they're still open.
Okay. I don't think he's a glutton, but I think I'll try my hand on this sword fighting thingy.
Okay.
So I guess I'll go up and approach that and start asking around and see if I could still enter it or not.
As you approach, a very young-looking, extremely beautiful fiendkin is sitting behind a table. The only table that's anywhere remotely near the kind of roped off area that two current fighters are fighting in. You approach and she just kind of looks at you. Oh, would you like to join?
Sure. Festivities seem interesting and I wouldn't mind putting my hand in the ring.
Well, it's 5 gold to enter and you get 3 gold per win. If you win the entire tournament, you get 100 gold.
I don't see why not. And I'll go ahead and pull out the 5 gold and give that to her.
Very good. You may wear your mail. There are no shields, and you will be given a wooden sword or club.
Okay. One second. Club. I will take the sword.
Long or short?
The longsword, please.
Very good. Your fight will be next. And you hand her the money, and she kind of reaches under the desk and pulls out a wooden sword and hands it to you. Please wait right over there for me, and we'll get you sorted out as soon as the fight's ready.
Okay.
So is there anyone else that is going to be up to anything for the rest of the night, or shall we just jump to Perrin?
Well, I think I'm
done. If at all possible to join that, I'd like to, but Johan has no way of knowing it without going back out after eating. And even then, he has to stumble across it.
So, Vel walks into the inn, and she looks pretty tired, and offhandedly mentions to Johan that she walked through the festivities that was going on. They seem to be having some sword fighting tournament or something. There's a lot of people who were like doing carnival tricks and very weird things, and eating challenges. It all seems pretty fun, but she's just too worn out to partake. She did say that there was a... She also says that there was a couple of soothsayers and diviners that seemed to be getting a lot of attention. And then she just kind of like stares off into nowhere and then heads to your guys' room.
Good night, Vel.
Hey, Johan.
Well, that doesn't sound like Vel at all.
It's weird, right?
It's kind of nice.
And talkative. How bizarre.
Yeah.
Yeah. Must be Selenmus. It's getting into everybody. So jovial.
All right. I finish my dinner and head back out to look for said festivities.
Okay. You come across them just as you see Perrin entering across from a... he's wearing a yellow stripe above his armor, and there is a fairly short human man on the other side wearing a red stripe. You see the Fiendkin woman. She kind of gets to the center of the pit. All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for our next duel between a... Perrin, I believe his name was, and your man, Rakia, from the West End. And you hear a small uproar around the pit, and you can see Rakia now swinging his longsword, kind of flourishing it a bit. Now, the rules of this match are simple. First to 3 hits win. If you hit in the head, that's 2 points. And with that, begin. Perrin, go ahead and roll initiative.
Yay, combat.
Yay, combat, kind of. Alright, so Perrin's 14. And this guy is... just lost. Alright, Perrin, your moves first.
Cool. Wait, am I just rolling strength then, since I don't actually have this item?
Yeah, you can just roll, you know what your bonus, it's, two, like, are you trained with it?
Longsword?
Yeah.
I'm trained with all weapons, armors, and shields, yeah. I would assume.
Okay, then.
Sword.
Then yes, you are. So it's a plus five, so go ahead and roll strength, plus five.
Okay.
Or actually, what's your strength at?
14.
Well, I mean,
fire 2.
Okay. All
right. So yeah, we'll just walk up to the guy and give him a good whacking.
So
I'm just gonna go ahead and just guide strike that just to avoid the one.
Nope, you take a one, bro. So, as you kind of move in, seeing this man's kind of arrogance, you rush forward, and he very quickly, as you lunge forward in your strike, slides his sword about your wrist and just kind of snaps it, and your sword sends clattering to the ground, and you just kind of look at him, and he just kind of looks back at you, and then he motions over to go and pick up your sword.
Okay, pick up my sword.
Okay. He will now attack.
Oh, I don't get my bonus action.
What are you going to do with your bonus action?
War
pick
domain.
Up a sword.
What?
Hit him. War domain.
Oh.
Hit him, since I get a bonus. Whereas my bonus action, I can attack again.
No, I'll let you do that. Go ahead.
Strength. A little better.
Okay, so that's... so your natural bonus on it is 2?
Yeah.
So it's a plus 4, so you rolled a 16. Okay. That hits. You hit him in the chest, and he kind of, like, smirks at you after that. And then he's going to take an attack. And he hits you. And you guys just kind of tap each other. And then he takes a few steps back. Your turn.
Really? He rolled a 16.
He rolled better. He rolled a nat 17.
That sucks for me.
Oh, damn.
Alright, well, step forward. Hit him again.
Okay.
That really sucks, so we're gonna just guide strike that.
Okay, that's a 14. 16 then? That hits?
10 plus whatever modifier you're adding to it, yeah.
Well, it's... you guys have 2 for your,
train
bonus, right?
No idea.
Your proficiency bonus is 2. Yeah, until
yes.
You hit level 6 when it becomes 3.
Then yes. Plus 12. So, there you go. You hit. Go ahead and...
cool.
You kind of lunge forward, and, you go in for a stab, which he definitely avoids, and then you snap your wrist up and tag him with the back edge of your blade. And you can see that he's a little upset about falling for your feint. He attacks and barely misses you.
Good. Is he done?
Yeah, that's his move.
Oh, okay.
Alright.
Oh. Heck him.
So, with a final thrust, you snap forward and quite quickly just hit him in the neck. And he looks a bit upset. Bit upset at you. That was your third hit, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was in 4 points right there.
He He looks at you and then just kind of like drops his sword, like, yeah, whatever. Pats you on the back and then walks out of the arena. The Fiendkin woman walks in, picking up his sword. Your winner! The Shashir Perrin! And, you can hear kind of like a muffled yay from the crowd.
Racist. All of you.
As you are... You're escorted out by the Fiendkin, who's like, we'll find you a new opponent fairly soon. Just wait over here. Blah, blah, blah. Johan, as you go up to the desk that the Fiendkin is sitting at, you can kind of hear, that guy cheated, didn't he? Are you allowed to use magic in this tournament? I don't know. Well, whatever, it's fine. Don't worry about it. Yeah, but that seems kind of bullshit, man. And you make your way to the table.
Okay, that was actually magic, though.
Guided strike is definitely magic.
Is it?
How is that not magic?
It's a channel divinity.
Yeah, it's magic.
That's magic, bro. It's
divine magic. You're getting it from the gods, the same place you get your magic from. Anyways, you make your way up and the Fiendkin just kind of like looks over at you. Would you also like to partake in our tournament?
I would. Would you mind explaining the rules to me?
Yes, you will be given a cudgel or a sword of wood. You may wear whatever armor you'd like, no shields. And it is the first to 3 points win. It's 5 gold to start. For every victory, you get 3 gold. If you win the entire tournament, you get 100 gold on top of that.
Must the strike be made with the weapon?
Yes.
Sad.
I don't get my multi-attacks, you bitch!
I thought it was just a brawling tournament. That's why when they were attacking the sword, it's like, oh, okay. Alright. I guess I'd still like to enter.
Alright, very good. Give me your entry fee. Would you like a cudgel or a sword?
A short sword, please.
Very well. And she kind of reaches under the table and after a few seconds pulls out a short sword and sets it on the table for you. Takes your gold. Go ahead and have a seat over there, and we'll get you your first opponent fairly soon.
Thank you, ma'am.
As you walk out, you walk over, and Perrin's sitting there, still looking pretty happy after his victory. Watching his defeated opponent kind of walk out. You see two new opponents gather in the middle of the ring. The Fiendkin goes out and introduces them both. One of them is a half-orc known as Shajik, and the other one is a... what are they called again? Lakir? Snow, right? Yeah, Lakir, mm-hmm. Known as Shell. And they are both fighting. Shajik using a club and Shell using a short sword. And in very quick order, Shajik lands a very crushing blow into her chest, but after falling back a little ways, she quickly counters with 2 quick strikes, both landing on him. Then he attacks again with his club, and she ducks under it, landing a final strike against his throat and claiming victory. And as the half-orc man is walking off, he's very visibly upset and He, like, throws his club down, nearly hitting the Fiendkin woman's leg as he does so.
Sorry, I missed that. You said he hit the Fiendkin woman in the leg?
Almost.
Okay.
Almost. The Fiendkin woman makes her way over to you, Johan, and then with a kind of coy finger, motions for you to, or beckons you over.
Okay.
And then beckons another fighter that's sitting next to Perrin. And you both find your way to the middle of the arena, and she introduces you. Ladies and gentlemen, from the East End, we have Roland, the Master Swordsman. And you can hear a small, yay. And newcomer to the city, Johan. And then Perrin's like, yeah, Johan! And with that, she counts you guys down and you begin your fight. Go ahead and roll initiative.
Also, since it's a short sword, I can roll this with dex for finesse, right?
What? Yes.
Okay.
Your attack, yes. 18. Wow, okay. Johan, 1-8. Prize fighter, 20. He's gonna go first, and he attacks you, and rolls a 16 to hit.
That is my AC, so he hits.
Okay. He very quickly steps forward and gets you just barely in the chest. That is your move.
Okay. I take a swing. So.
Twelve misses.
Okay. Also, do I add my proficiency? What were we doing for... I mean, a 14 is probably still going to miss, but...
yeah, 14 proficiency misses. Yes, you add proficiency if you're not.
Yep. Yeah. So then, yeah, it's a 14, but it still misses.
Yeah. All right. He attacks again. He misses. Your turn.
Okay.
Seeing your attack fall short of him, kind of thinks he's playing. He can play it a length game against you, but he also misses his attack because you have ample time to dodge.
I make my attack.
Ooh. Seeing the opportunity as he misses, you rush through the breach and attack at his head, hitting him, and he kind of stumbles back for a second. And then he kind of... he's trying to shake it off, and he doesn't attack you.
Okay. So my turn again?
Yeah. He's kind of, he's playing defensively at the moment. So.
All right.
Yeah.
Should I roll this?
At disadvantage.
Okay.
All right. A 10. Yeah, he's definitely focusing on not getting hit. Since he's already lost 2 points in one go, he's just playing very defensively. And then, he decides to make kind of a guarded strike against you, which barely misses.
Okay. I'm also going to attempt to hit.
Okay. You do.
Okay.
You, as you see the opening in his strike, you kind of reach your left hand up and grab it, and just with your short sword, hit him across his stomach and win the match. And, he bows to you quite graciously.
I flip my sword down like this and bow.
Okay. He returns the bow graciously before handing his sword to the Fiendkin woman and walking off. You're led back, and the Fiendkin woman approaches both you and Perrin. And, well, I apologize, but it seems we're running low on competitors. Would you two mind having a bout?
Not at all, Perrin.
I would be glad to do battle with you, Yon.
Very good. And then she kind of, like, she gives you, Johan, a couple of minutes to rest up. Like, she doesn't immediately take you out, but pretty quickly, she brings you back out to the center, and first raising Perrin's hand. Ladies and gentlemen, the Shashir, Perrin, and then the human, Johan, and fight. And both of you go ahead and roll initiative. Wow.
Well done. Get wrecked.
Apparently.
Perrin wants this. Perrin needs
this. Well, no, isn't that two people in a row who've rolled 20s on initiative against me? Or did the guy just roll a 20 after his modifier?
Yeah, the guy rolled a 18 and then had a plus 2 modifier.
Okay, well, you just said he got a 20, so...
Yeah, nat 20.
Okay.
And, yeah, okay. That's, Perrin, what are you gonna do?
Just advance and attack.
Okay. Pretty sure you hit.
Oh, nice.
Sorry.
You cleave your wooden longsword up, and before Johan has even time to realize the fight has started, you get smacked across the chest, and it kind of sends you back a little bit. Johan? Or, Perrin, is there anything else you'd like to do?
No, I'm not fair fight with him, so...
Okay. Johan?
Alright, I'm gonna charge back. You said he knocked me back, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I'm gonna charge back into the fray and slash.
Okay.
That's a 17.
Baron, does that beat your AC?
Yes, that does it.
So, yes, you slide back towards him and catch his upper shoulder with your short sword. Perrin?
Return the favor.
It's a miss.
Okay. Perrin, you bring your sword down and Johan ducks under it.
I'm gonna go in for a jab.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Johan, you make a quick jab as he overextends and you catch Perrin in the stomach.
Okay.
Okay. Again. Oh, that sucks.
Alright, you kind of shocked at how dexterous and fast Johan has recovered, make a kind of downward sweep at his legs, which he backs away from just before lunging forward again.
I'm going to play off of that and just go for my lunge.
Okay. And he, again, just kind of very quickly hits you in the ribs, claiming his third point.
All good.
Once again, I flip the sword down and bow to Perrin.
Do the same.
The Fiendkin woman walks back out and holds out her hand for Perrin's sword.
Good, give it to her.
And then kind of motions for Johan to go and sit down.
Okay.
Perrin, as you're leaving, the Finkin woman kind of follows you and reaches into her purse and hands you 3 gold pieces. There's another fight that goes on between a hill dwarf or an Axe Clan dwarf and a Uthfei. Or at least they said she was an Uthfei, but you can't really tell because she's just wearing a cowl over her. Which the Uthfei woman barely wins. 2-3 And it wasn't a very clean fight, but she does win. The Fiendkin woman comes back to you, Johan, and says that you will be in the next fight.
Thank you, ma'am.
Leads you out and introduces you first, and you get a pretty big cheer as you're now fairly far into the tournament. And then introduces your opponent, Chell, who also gets a fairly raucous applause. Go ahead and roll for initiative.
Okay.
19.
Come on, 20.
Wow, okay.
Another 20 plus.
Go ahead and beat a 9 with a d20 roll.
Okay.
Alright, you get initiative.
Okay. In that case, I'm going to charge in for a quick slash.
Okay. You hit, you come up and very quickly land a slash against her chest. And you can see kind of like anticipation in her eyes as you do that. And she immediately strikes back at you.
Okay.
And 14 misses, I assume?
Yes.
Okay. It's your turn.
Okay. Give me just 1 second. I think that ought to do it. This will just be easier than having... Okay, good. Yeah, so that misses, I assume.
Yep.
Okay.
You lunge forward in an attack, and it flies wide. And you can see that anticipation in her eye turn to very sharp focus, and she lobs 2 attacks your way.
Okay.
And her first attack stunningly uppercuts and catches your jaw, snapping your head back. And you reel backwards, and she lunges forward again, and you barely bring your sword up to parry. And you're kind of still just reeling backward a bit. But it's your move.
Okay. I try and turn my backwards momentum into, like, a spinning swing.
You spin around and with your short sword smack her across the jaw. And you actually see a small spittle of blood come out from her busted lip. And she lunges at you again. But completely messes up her footing and kind of just tumbles to the ground, but gets to her feet quite quickly. It's your move.
I back up and take a defensive stance and let her get back to the ready.
Yeah, she's ready.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Then in that case, I'm going to go in for just a quick jab.
Okay. You do. You rush forward and jab and get just under her defenses, and you can hear an exasperated "damn it" as she feels your strike land. She kind of just throws down her short sword, looks at you, and then gives a kind of curt bow.
I set my sword down and walk over to ask if she's all right, because I did see the blood.
What, this? Yeah, I'm fine. Don't worry about it. Doesn't hurt half as much as my pride.
Well, it was a splendid spar, and I returned the bow just late.
She begins walking off, and... yeah, well, I'll have to do it again sometime. And then continues walking.
I'll hold you to it.
You're, again, led to the seats. And then there is another match, the other semifinal, which is one, again, barely and not very cleanly, by the hooded woman, okay. who is only going, like, the only thing you know about her is that she's a half-elf. And then the final. Johan, you are let out and introduced first, and this time there is uproarious applause as you are introduced. And the other woman, or the woman, the half-elf, gets some fair applause, but not quite as uproarious as yours. Go ahead and roll initiative.
Okay.
That was pretty great.
That was long overdue, but...
Alright, she is going to attack first. And a 14 misses?
Yes.
Okay. She misses with her first attack.
Okay.
Your turn.
Oh, sorry. I thought she was going to attack twice. I retaliate. And also miss.
And also miss.
With almost another one.
It's not very clean, these fights that are going on with this woman. You're not sure why, it just seems like harder to hit her for some reason. She attacks at you, and it's bizarre. She attacked, and very quickly, or not quickly, very clearly, like, just it wafted by the side of you. You didn't really even have to dodge it, even though you did take a step, and then you attacked, and you kind of thought your strike was going to land true, but she just miraculously kind of ducked under it in a very awkward fashion. And as she's coming up from that, she brings up her short sword and just cleaves into your jaw, sending you reeling backwards for the second time, and you can now feel blood trickling down the back of your throat.
Okay.
Your turn.
I take a moment to regain myself, steady myself, and then I move in for a low strike.
Okay. You get it. You bring your sword up just under her her thigh, just above the knee, and you can hear a slight pfft, as she takes the blow.
Okay.
And since you're one away from elimination, I'll just roll them in front of you. These get plus four to them, so you know.
Okay. Oh, also, out of curiosity, in the last fight, headshots are worth two, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when I hit her in the jaw, how come I needed four? Because I hit her three times regularly and once in the jaw.
Did you hit her three times regularly?
Yeah, because I got my 22, then I got my nat 20.
22, 13, nat 20.
And then another 23.
Oh. I didn't notice that you got the first hit.
Okay, that's fine. I was just making sure that that was, in fact, the rule. Because yes. You said I was one away from elimination, so.
Yes.
That's it, that's all. Okay. We're all good. So everything's rolled with a plus four, so that one misses. So my turn.
Yeah, your turn.
Oh.
She, again, almost as though she's, like, drunk, rushes forward, and this time you're prepared for it, and you sidestep and hit her in the chest, across the rib cage, and again, you can hear a, and she makes another attack at you, and misses.
Right.
And as she misses, you can kind of hear an exasperated, "Damn it!"
I'm going to, what was her last strike like? You said downward?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm going to go for the upward strike.
Okay. And you catch her off guard, and you bring it up, and you quite impactfully hit her chest. And as she kind of leans into it, the tip of your sword catches her hood and flips her hood back, and she immediately, like, kind of rushes to cover her face, throwing her sword down. Go ahead and roll perception.
Okay. Come on, nat one again.
You've noticed her slightly elvish features before as she turns and begins running out of the tournament square.
Okay.
And with that, the very beautiful Fiendkin woman walks out. My ladies, my lords, your tournament champion, Johan! And she raises your hand, and there's a colossal, thunderous cheer that Hale can hear, Sarkesh can hear, the entire town can hear. She holds up your hand, and you kind of just sit there for a second, taking it all in. And then she sets a chest in front of you, or a small chest in front of you, saying that your winnings are in there.
As she does give a humble bow to the crowd, so, and I return her weapon to her.
She kind of, like, continues doing this, she's like, that was very impressive. Perhaps you could be of some service to me.
Service of what sort, madam?
Well, I'm always looking for talented people, and you show no lack of that. And she kind of slides a piece of parchment into your hand as she's, you know, still helping cheer with you. Mm-hmm. Let me know if it interests you. You can meet me there if you would like. And then she kind of, like, walks off.
Okay.
As you're standing in the middle of the ring and everyone's cheering, and Perrin's like, yeah, Johan!
I know that guy!
Yeah!
I lost to him! Yay!
I got beat by the guy who won it all! Yeah!
I broke him out of prison! Tell everyone the story of those people you murdered. And the treason.
But yes, everyone is quite celebratory.
I give a few more bows before grabbing my chest and just heading over towards Perrin, speaking to anyone who makes their way towards the ring. But
mm-hmm. A lot of people just want to, like, shake your hand and say, you know, good fight. It was really impressive. Where are you from? That kind of just general stuff like that.
Okay. I make small talk with anyone who has any questions. You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's all very
innocuous.
Civil and innocuous small talk.
Okay.
And you make your way to Perrin.
Well, that was certainly eventful, wouldn't you say?
Yes, it's a very interesting festivities going on, and this sort of duel thing was very interesting. Definitely think I'll look to partake in more of these in the future.
I must say, I never found myself much one for the sword, but perhaps I should look into it.
But, definitely seemed like you knew how to use it quite well.
Standard military training, but I wasn't aware I'd taken to it.
Definitely.
Well, shall we head back to the inn?
Certainly, I think a celebration is in hand.
Excellent.
Alright, you guys begin making your way back to the inn. Hale, you've been reading through the book for quite a while. It seems to be mostly it's an extensive compendium of knowledge of medicinal and magical herbs and plants and the proper care for them, the growing of them. And it's all essentially in like alphabetical order, so you're pretty much reading through like an encyclopedia. But you do spend as much time as possible reading all of this. Go ahead and roll an intelligence check. Good. Give me a minute. Everyone with the crits today. Jesus, guys. Come on.
No middle ground.
Apparently not. What you had used, or what flower you had found yesterday. The plant that you had been asked to grow is in fact known as the Mobius flower. It's a pale blue swamp flower, which has a very potent, it has very potent magical properties in that it can cure any known disease to any creature that is a non-magical disease. Near instantly. It's exceedingly rare and very expensive. But it has a very, very severe reaction to magic, as you well know, in that it will continue to grow essentially forever in a attempt to defend itself. It's been known to get up to 400 to 500 meters long in thick, near impenetrable vine to defend itself. And it's also been known, if someone drinks it who is a magic user and they use magic within the first 2 days of consuming the elixir, that it will begin to grow tendrils through them, killing the drinker. To which that there is no known remedy or cure for that doesn't involve killing the host. Sir Kesh, you continue to just kind of bump around reading about the Black Mountain. There's a lot of interesting tales from the Black Mountain. There's a tale that you read that you kind of got stuck on and fascinated by of a man that would walk to the top of the mountain, and at the top of the mountain he created a shrine of 7 stones, and on these 7 stones he wrote down the names of all the gods. And every year he would go to his town, the town of Dunwich, and buy a goat and bring the goat up and sacrifice it. And he did this for I think it was 48 years. And on the 49th year, when he brought the goat up, a beacon of brilliant light that could be seen as far away as Oliver and Zelotath could be seen piercing the veil of night. The man after that was never heard from again, but there are legends still that say that the 7 stones, which stand as mute sentinel of the Black Mountain, have converged into a place of most powerful sorcery, that the sacrifice that the man made essentially moved the very ley lines of the elixir or the ether on the planet to converge with the Black Mountain.
Well, I guess that story can be relevant. I'll keep it to the side. I'm going to check, see if they have any designs on Necronian armor and weapons.
They have a general compendium, which you believe is probably compiled from during the war, of Necronian weapon and armor that they quite often encountered. It's not particularly different than normal armor. It tends to be a bit lighter and darker due to the ash that kind of permeates the interior of Necros from the volcano. And the just general high temperature of the deserts of Necros.
Are there any weapons that the paladins would normally wield in the book?
You don't find any. It's not. It doesn't mention paladins specifically. It's essentially just a book of military arms and armor that is common to be encountered, and essentially like where the gaps are, and what you should like. It's a treatise on the best way of taking out Necronians, which appear to be use an axe and hit hard. For the most part. But you could extrapolate that they would probably wear heavier mail as a paladin, just from your training.
Nothing on the weapons or anything? Any sketches or anything?
Yeah, there are some sketches of Necronian weapons. They use almost scythe-like sickles quite commonly in their offhand, though Necronians tend to prefer long and short sword. That is kind of a unique thing that they also use to get around armor and hook onto shields to kind of open their opponents up. They tend to be a more offensive group of fighters. They don't... Those shields are still commonly used. You see more sketches of people wielding two weapons, a defensive weapon and a purely offensive weapon, which you find to be a bit interesting.
Well, I take a sketch of my own sketch of a sword with a hook on the back of it, just mixing the long sword with the scythe, trying to make my own design of a weapon, and I'm going to take it to the blacksmith before he closes.
Okay. Let's see. Make a don't know what, like, tinkering would necessarily be, so I guess an intelligence check?
Waha!
Alright, you make a rough sketch of what you think would blend a longsword and a hook scythe together, and take it to a blacksmith who says that they could probably do it for you for about 20 gold.
Should be fine. I'm gonna be here for a while, so I won't mind waiting.
Okay. It'll take them about a week. It'll be 20 gold, and they'd like to know where they can reach you.
I'll be at the barracks. If you can't reach me, I'll be at the barracks. Otherwise, I'll be on patrol.
Very good. And he takes your sketch, and you can see him kind of like refining some of the lines on it, even as he takes it away. Trying to proportion it out all in his head.
Okay, and now I'm just gonna go eat and sleep at the barracks.
Okay. You begin making your way back to the barracks. As you're kind of crossing, you can see Johan and Perrin in the midst of, or in the middle of, like, kind of a celebration. There seems to be a lot of people gathered around them. All of you can also notice that, you know, there's there's growing lines in front of particular shops as you're making your way through the town.
I'm going to stop and see what's going on at one of the shops.
Okay. Can I see which particular shops have the growing lines?
Some of the shops are like psychic, diviner, or soothsayer. Other shops are ones that say that they have those in at the moment. But it seems to be a very popular activity.
Okay.
For
I just asked some people what the lines are for.
They're so we can know our future and if next year will be good harvest.
Always good to know. Where I come from, though, work is usually the best way to get that.
Yes, but what could it hurt?
Good point. Well, have a good night. And I'm going to the barracks now.
Okay. Johan, Perrin, you guys are both heading back to the inn.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Right. So, as you're heading back to the inn and barracks, and Hale, as you're kind of flipping through your tome, you all hear a calamitous and loud explosion. Hale, the ground beneath you shakes as you look up through the glass panes of the greenhouse, and you can see about halfway up the castle a gout of flame burst out. Johan, Sarkash, and Perrin, you all hear this and the crowd gasps and you can hear screams coming from the entirety of the center of town.
Oh, okay, so it's the center town, not the palace.
That's screaming that you can hear. Yes.
Oh, got it. Not quite back yet.
Palace at all?
No, you guys are still heading back through the town.
Okay.
But yes, there is. You can see a large gout of flame also escaping, but Hale, being close, sees like the full extent of the damage.
Okay, I'm going to go get the guard. I'm going to tell Johan. I'm going to get the guard captain and try and rally as many people as we can. If you can check on the screaming, it would be very much appreciated.
Johan's already gone.
Okay, I'm running to the barracks to get the captain.
Okay. Perrin, what are you doing?
Following Johan.
Okay. Hale, what are you doing?
Heading up to the source of the commotion.
Okay. You all... well, actually, Johan, where are you headed? I didn't ask that.
Well, since I can't see the source of the explosion or the boom or the noise, I'm just heading towards the screaming.
Okay. Well, you could hear that the explosion came from the palace area.
Okay. Are the screams in like the opposite direction, or
well,
are they
the screams
more
are just
less...
from everywhere?
Oh, okay. You said something was from the center of town.
Yeah, that's because that's where you are. That's where you're hearing the screams.
Got it.
But it's from, like, all over, because other people are wondering what happened, what's going on. And,
okay, in that case, I'm headed towards the source of the...
Okay. You all begin going your separate directions. Sarkash, you're tearing through the town, pushing through as many people as you can to get back to the barracks. Johan, with Perrin following closely behind, are pushing through people heading towards the palace. Hale, you immediately fearing for Vel, who you haven't seen since a little past her lunch, burst out of the greenhouse and, with little thought of your own safety, storm into the castle. As you are all rushing your various ways, a very loud boom erupts from directly above. It's almost omnipresent. It's so loud. And then immediately after it, you hear nothing. Like, Johan, you're running through a crowd. You can see people screaming. Sarkesh, you can see the man next to you pointing and yelling. Perrin, you can see children crying, looking around for their parents, their guardians. But you hear nothing.
Quick clarification. Is there a ringing in my ears, or is it nothing?
Nothing. There's no ringing. There is absolutely no sound. You can't even hear yourself. You can't hear your breath or your heartbeat. Nothing.
Okay.
I look at where the guy is pointing while he's screaming.
You look over and you can see him pointing to the palace, and there is now this very large jet of flame that is rushing up the side of the palace and coiling around the top of the palace itself. Almost serpentine or snake-like, curling to the highest spires of the palace.
How close am I to the witchery?
A couple blocks.
I'm heading there instead of the barracks. I'm getting as many reinforcements as I can and heading to the palace.
Okay, you immediately turn around and break towards the witchery at a full sprint. Johan, Perrin, Hale, what are you guys
I'm
up
just
to?
Continuing towards the... I can see a basically pillar of fire that's almost serpentine coiling around the tower now. Yeah, I'm heading there.
Okay.
Keep following.
Hale, you heard the boom. You can't see any fire. You're in the palace. You can see everyone's in a panic. People are starting to yell orders. And then everything just goes silent.
Okay. I'm still going to continue heading to where I initially saw the first explosion come from.
Okay. You begin climbing staircases with some of the palace guard in front and behind you, all pushing up to try and help. Or do what can be done at the top of the palace. A few seconds later, the first sound echoes through, but you all immediately kind of innately realize with a kind of sickening tightening of your chest that the sound is non-diegetic and that it's emanating from within your mind. And you hear the words, "The Mage's College has failed you. They cannot protect you anymore. We are coming. Join us. Power should be where it has always been kept from. The people will rise. The rebellion is started." And after that, there is utter silence. You can now, Johan, Sarkesh, Perrin, even you, Hale, you kind of see everyone stop as that echoes through your mind. And as the silence slowly lifts, everyone is kind of stunned, and then you hear crying and screaming as everyone kind of snaps back into what's happening. Sarkesh, you make it to the witchery, and you can already see Lady Rocha out front, and a line of 40 witchers all essentially, like, donning their armor as she's, like, just pointing and yelling, now her voice finally coming back. "We have to get to the castle. We need to see what's going on. You..." And she finally kind of realizes it. "Good. You three, go to the front gate and make sure no one leaves. Anyone who tries to leave Deadwood dies." And she turns around and immediately catches you. "Good. Sarkesh, you should come with us."
That's what I was trying to come here to get. It was aid. It's always good to have aid when something like this happens. Let's go.
Yes, and... all of the witchers begin rushing with you towards the castle. Hale, sound now coming back. You can hear orders being levied. You are now starting to understand that the area that the explosion took place was in the laboratory of the mages. It could have even been from the High Mage's room as you begin to climb the flights and flights of stairs to get up there. Johan, you and Perrin make it to the base of the palace, and you can see all of the guards of the city, essentially, rushing forward. You can see some of the nobles and other people of the palace rushing out. You see Maester Judic kind of rushing away from the palace.
How far away are we / is everyone else?
You guys are about a couple hundred feet away from the entrance.
Okay. And everyone's spilling out of the entrance / exit? Okay. I suppose I run up to Judic and stop briefly. How many people are still left inside?
Hundreds? I don't know.
Get to safety. See what you can do about keeping these people organized.
He nods and begins kind of like moving forward still. Mm-hmm. You and Perrin now rush into the castle, followed shortly by Sir Kesh and the Sisters of the Witchery. Hale, you finally make it up to the floor in which the explosion took place, and it's covered in this thick, viscous oil set aflame. You can see guards attempting to put it out with like heavy sheets that have been wetted, and no matter how many times they hit the flames refuse to be quenched.
I'm going to tell them to stop with the water, do their best to go out and get as much dirt as they can, or sand or anything, and come and throw it on the fire, and I'm going to assist them with that.
Okay. You begin, and you roll persuasion. Alright, you convince the nearest kind of like 10 people to assist you, and they begin, you know, running down to go and pull as much dirt as they can from the nearby area and begin kind of trying to conveyor it back up. But it's a fairly slow process. Johan, Perrin, you guys now make it to the interior of the castle, and you can see everyone still kind of rushing in kind of an incoherent mob.
Rushing toward the exits?
Just rushing everywhere.
How many people would you say, roughly?
60?
Like, in this particular area. Huh? 60?
Okay. Between guards and civilians? 60.
All right. I shout out to the into the halls as best I can to get over the clamor. Civilians, outside, rendezvous at the front gate in an orderly fashion.
All right. Roll persuasion for me.
Okay. 3rd one of the day.
That's a pretty good day for you, isn't it?
I got 100 gold.
Yeah,
so.
It wasn't bad.
It wasn't a bad day, just not good for talking to people.
Your voice can't even carry over the sounds of the other soldiers barking orders at each other and the pandemonium in front of you. No one pays any attention to you. Sarkesh, you now enter, and the Sisters of the Witchery just kind of fan out and begin heading up the stairs. You can see Johan and Perrin in the entranceway.
I'm going to begin heading up the stairs with the sisters, seeing what I can do up top.
Okay.
Are the guards trying to manage the people down at the bottom?
Yes, some of them are trying to corral people.
Okay, then I'll continue onwards, because there's nothing more I can do.
Okay. In quick order, the four of you make your way to the main floor of the explosion, and it is still engulfed in this viscous, thick, brown ooze that has an unquenchable fire that people are trying to throw water on, dampen with towels, do anything, but nothing seems to be working. Hail comes up and throws dirt, or a fairly large bucket of dirt on it, and it seems to prevent the fire from escaping that area.
So it's not successfully smothering it? It's just preventing its spread?
Maybe.
From what I can tell.
From what you can tell.
Okay.
How large would you say the area is? I mean, the whole area. A
couple hundred square feet.
Is there an entire wall of flame yet?
Well, the entire room is essentially just in flame.
I'm going to, just to test, I'm going to walk up to the flame and speak in my primal tongue to try and get anything's attention if there's any intelligent creature there.
Okay, what do you say?
I'm just asking to speak. I'm the only one that can speak its tongue. At least speak to me before any of this gets any further out of hand.
And all of you can hear the response, though none of you understand the meaning. Or rather, none of you can comprehend what's actually being said.
You are not my master.
No, my father is.
Who are you?
Sarkesh Nima.
Sarkesh. I've not heard that name.
My father barely held on to me last time. He'll probably still be searching for me.
Who is your father, Nima?
That's a name I won't even privilege my friends, let alone you. So you're here on the orders of the rebellion?
I am here on the orders of my master.
And your master is?
I don't even privilege my friends.
You don't even have friends.
Exactly.
And you can all hear this, like, deep churning pulsing of flame as Sarkesh is just standing at the edge of flame while everyone's trying to, like, pour water, put things out, and he's just, like, talking to the fire in this very odd, guttural language.
What does your master desire?
Chaos.
That's always what you elementals desire. Never any true meaning behind your actions.
You just never comprehend, mortal.
It's said, maybe the wind elemental would have fun with you.
So what are the rest of you doing as this is kind of taking place?
I'm doing my best to assist in... Well, actually, what does the room that the fire is in look like? Is it a stone room?
It's a stone room, as all the castle is. There was wood floor paneling on it, and shelf upon shelves of what you assume to be books and vials. There's shattered glass strewn about, vast tomes set ablaze. You can see in at least two bodies that are now just seared bone.
Well, for the time being, I'm going to assist in attempting to smother the flame, or at least get rid of some of its fuel.
Baron?
I'm going to keep trying to smother it as well.
Okay.
You said the gel is, like, everywhere in the room?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, as far as you... Because you can't really, like, tell after the kind of huge gouts of flame, but as far as you can see, yeah, you can see it kind of just slowly dripping and oozing down. It seemed to have kind of exploded out, and then now it's kind of just dripping back down, although the roof is still quite ablaze, so you're not entirely sure how... necessary, the ooze is to the fire, but it still seems quite potent and all over the place.
Yeah. I think I'm gonna dump out my water skin and collect some of this.
Okay. You, do your best, using... Actually, how do you go about trying to collect it? Because most of it's pretty much a flame.
I guess I'll attempt to sneak in after somebody's tried to, like, put out part of the flame. And
okay.
Try to just scoop it up that way.
Okay. So yes, you all continue to try and douse the fire as best you can. Perrin, you get, 1 pound of the oil in your water skin. As you kind of quickly shove it in as soon as it's been completely doused, and you push it in. Sarkesh, you hear, a response.
Nima, why do you delay me?
All I wish is a challenge. I want to fight one of my own kind for once.
A challenge.
Take a form I can fight you in, and we'll see who's the better combatant. Whoever wins can deal out their form of chaos.
And in front of you, you see a... cone of flame converge into a tighter and tighter and tighter ball. And within this ball of etheric flame are two bright white eyes, and a darkening orange smile creeps across it.
I draw my sword and prepare for combat.
Okay, go ahead and roll initiative. Is you? Five. Ah, I can't edit the guy's name. Sad. Ba-ba-ba-bum. Wow. All the low rolls today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't worry, you'll both be scoring nat 20s against each other.
Can't wait. All right, give me like 2 seconds. All right, so.
Silence.
I'm just reading the Fire Elemental page, so I don't have to continually jump back and forth between it. Alright, so the elemental rushes you, and it attacks twice by grabbing at you. And the first one hits. It's got a plus 6 to this, so. And the second one misses. So you take 5 damage. And your armor is now aflame.
I'm going to convert that flame into a burning hands.
Okay.
Stop the fire with more fire!
Saving throw now.
Haven't you ever heard of fight with fire with fire?
Not when you're in a burning building.
This is a battle of elementals.
That shit's for forest fires.
What's the DC on it?
Yeah, it is
a 14 on its save. I think it's like 13 or something like that.
My god. It is 10, so I only get to roll 1d8.
Okay. Roll it up. Alright. You can see now, another soldier kind of rush forward to attack it. And it... as the soldier rushes forward, it attacks both you and the soldier. We'll do the soldier first, and then you, unless you want a bonus action.
I'm gonna hit it with my other spell.
Okay.
My Divine Smite.
Is Burning Hands a bonus action?
Oh, no, no. Well, actually...
Cause...
Hang on. Oh, sorry. No, it's just an instant.
No. So then you can only use something that is classed as a bonus action.
Oh, wait. That thing still took damage then, didn't it? Burning Hands says that on a failed save it takes 3d6, but on a half as
took
much
7
success.
Damage.
That's weird.
Oh, yeah, you should have rolled 3d6, not 1d8 for Burning Hands.
Okay, oh. Yeah. Sorry.
Because it's 3d6 so. Halved, not 1d8.
Let me just re-roll that then.
I was going to say, 1d8 is a really weird roll for a spell.
Yeah. Okay, so 13 halved, got it. 6 damage.
So 1 under what I did.
Yep. So is there anything else that you want to do?
Gonna take my defensive stance and call out, leave this one to me. I challenged it formally. It is my opponent.
Okay. Defensive stance is an action, so you're just standing there as you call that out.
Yeah.
But yeah, you bring your shield up and stuff. He begins to slow down, but isn't fast enough, and the fire elemental attacks him, and then you. Hits. Immediately as the guard turns to you, he's just engulfed in a pillar of flame, and you also feel flame go about yourself as well, and you take 5 damage. And since... Yes. Okay. There you go.
Okay, I'm going to hit it with my longsword.
Okay, go for it. Roll to hit. That is a miss.
Well then.
Any bonus action you want to take?
I don't know if I have any bonus actions.
Okay then.
Because I know Divine Smite's only after I use a physical attack. But it has to hit.
So, now this has gone on long enough, and you've probably heard the screams of the dude who was set on fire. The rest of you all see and notice Sarkesh battling a living flame in the middle of this fire. He's on the edge of the fire, but the flame is still within the fire itself. What do the rest of you do?
Did I hear what he say, that he wanted us to stay out of that fight?
Yeah, you probably would have heard that.
Okay, then I guess I'm going to focus on trying to save the soldier.
Okay, what do you do?
Bonus action, we'll try to heal him, so... that one. So I'm going to use my healing word on him.
Okay. Okay, you heal him for 6.
Okay.
He's still aflame.
Okay, and then I'm going to... I guess... Well, okay, so he's in the fire area. I don't really have much that can help him. Water, and I just poured out my water. I don't know, what kind of action is it to try to put the fire out of on him if I approach him?
Do you have an action?
Yeah, because healing went that.
That's
one
a bonus action.
A bonus
okay.
Action, yeah.
Go ahead and make either athletics or acrobatics check. To attempt to put out the fire.
Okay. Approach him and try to put it out.
Nice, yeah. You immediately jump, grab a thick blanket that someone else was trying to use to put out a fire, yank it out of their hands, and, like, start slamming it down on this guy. And fairly quickly, you manage to douse the flame that was covering him. He seems quite shocked and amazed to be alive.
Okay, then...
As he's kind of scooting back away from the living fire.
Right, I'll just kind of escort him kind of towards the staircase, I guess.
Okay. Hale, what are you up to?
Is there any water in the room at all, so that I don't have to use my water skin?
There are some people, like, that have, like, wet sheets and buckets of water that they're throwing, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to use Create Water with a second level spell slot, which, and I'm going to have it rain down. Do you want me to link that into the chat for you?
Yeah, sure. 10 gallons of water.
Plus an additional 10 with a second spell slot. And it'll rain down in a 35-foot cube. And I'm going to try and aim it over where the living fire elemental is.
Okay, so you want it, like, 30 feet essentially centered off of that? Okay. I believe that... As this happens, you can see the living flame kind of... condense slightly as the water begins to hit it.
A dirty trick.
Johan, what are you up to? You're muted, by the way.
Sorry, my bad. How much non-flaming dirt is there lying around?
Not a lot, because basically as soon as anyone comes up, they throw the dirt on the flames to try and put it out.
That's what I meant. Like, how much of that dirt on the ground is on fire, and how much of it is just kind of...
None of it's on fire. You mean how much is on top of the fire?
Basically, if I went over to go grab some, would I be able to do so without getting burned?
You're not sure. It probably wouldn't be very safe.
Okay, then I'll just, I'll skip that step, and I'm going to jump into the fray with the fire elemental.
Okay. How do you choose to
roll initiative, or?
No, that's fine. How do you choose to attack?
I'm going to enter the fight with a leaping kick, I suppose.
Okay. Roll to hit. That does indeed hit.
Okay.
Alright, cool.
And I'm gonna whip back around, and I'm going... Hang on, give me just a second, I need to check. Okay, yeah, I'm going to... spend a key point to do Flurry of Blows.
Go for it. That misses.
Okay.
Oh no, that actually just hits. Sorry.
Okay. In that case, have it make a dex saving throw with a DC of 12, because I'm attempting to knock it prone.
It can't be knocked prone.
Oh.
You hit it, and the force of your blow, as you try and knock it down, just wafts straight through the flame.
Well, it still does damage, it's just an additional effect, just for the record.
I know. So, okay. So go ahead and deal the damage.
Okay.
Okay.
And...
That misses.
Yes. Okay.
All right. The fire elemental. Yeah, okay. The fire elemental, now being attacked on multiple fronts, seems a bit annoyed, and reaches out to grab both Johan and Sarkash, being the two closest people. Gonna go with Johan first. That was a... Oh. I probably should have rolled that normally, because that's what I was doing. It's a 21.
Okay, that manages.
And
just
another
barely.
21. Look at that, two 15s in a row. Alright, so both of you take 5 damage, and you are both alight.
Okay.
And on fucking fire! So it's free
the
game!
The fire's not what hurts, though. It's what he is doing when he hits us.
Well, I mean, the fire would hurt if he stopped hitting you.
True.
Alright, so you both take 5 damage. Sarkash, your turn.
Okay, I'm pulling the fire in and using another burning hands, getting the fire off of us for a moment.
You can do that for yourself, but it's not going to absorb Johan's.
Okay, I'll just absorb it off of me then. No more ticking damage.
Okay. That is... Wow, just makes the DC, I think.
Yeah, just makes it.
So 3d6 halved. Alright, thank you. That's...
Another 5.
Yeah. Johan, that brings us to you.
Okay.
As you're on fucking fire.
You said, like, acrobatics to...
Mm-hmm. Acrobatics or athletics, whichever one you prefer to try and get it off you.
Okay.
Okay. Basically begin... You stop, drop, and roll really quickly along the ground. And as you're rolling, you eventually get the fire off of you. That's your action.
Okay.
You have any bonus actions you want to do?
Um, I just want to make sure that I stand back up.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. And defensive stance is an action, mm-hmm. right? Disengage is an action, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Unless I use Step of the Wind. Then, in that case...
All default things are actions.
Yeah. I'm going to use another key point to use Patient Defense. So I have effectively dodged.
Okay.
Or I am dodging.
Yeah, you use dodge, essentially. Okay.
Yeah. I'll try to phrase that.
Hale, what are you up to?
So I have a question. Yes. Clearly the elemental is not extinguished, but the area around him was in explosive flames, and it does say that it extinguishes explosive flames in the area. Did that extinguish any of the flames?
Essentially what's happened for that is it went down, and the elemental took damage, but not enough to kill it, obviously. And it's hit the flames, and the flames are essentially being extinguished and kindled effectively at the same time, which is just causing mass amounts of hot steam to kind of come up from the floor.
Is it still raining, or does it just...
Well, it ends at the end of your turn, yeah.
Okay, that's what I wasn't sure about.
So we got a bunch of water vapor in here now.
Yes, the room is getting very humid very fast.
Well, it's better than what it was.
Which is good, that weakens fire.
So now what do you want to do?
I'm going to do it again using a second level spell slot.
Okay. You do it again. You can see that the flames are visibly weakening on the floor. The elemental itself is still going pretty strong, though. Excellent. That would be Perrin. Perrin, what are you up to?
I was told not to engage the thing. Most of my spells deal fire damage, so there's probably not a lot I can do there. Well, I don't know. Divine Flame might be different, I guess.
If it deals radiant damage, that is not fire damage.
That's true.
Yep.
How much damage has Johan taken so far?
Five.
And Sir Cash?
10.
A lot, because I was at 28. I'm at 12 now.
I have to be able to touch for that one. Okay. Go ahead and do his bonus action healing word for Sir Kesh.
Okay. Roll it up. Yeah, you got 5 more HP, Sir Kesh.
I
can take another hit.
Yeah.
Let's see.
As Perrin speaks a prayer, Sarkash, you can feel your burns kind of reverting back into your body and being washed over with new, untarnished skin. Still really hot in here, though.
I'm still not sweating yet.
No, but it's getting warm. I mean, not that you'll ever start sweating in here, because it's a fucking sauna, and you'll never notice.
Not to mention, Sarkash sleeps right next to a fire, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know there's anything that I want to do, because I was told not to attack it.
Okay.
So I guess I'll assume a dodging stance for my action, then.
Very good. The elemental... Johan, did you want to come back into the fight, or did you just stand up away from it?
I'm staying in the fight.
Okay, then it's going to make an attack on Johan. misses. Because that's a 14. That misses, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, and it was supposed to make a disadvantage anyway, so.
Oh, yeah. And then an attack on Sarkesh. That one probably hits. 20.
Yeah, 20 hits.
Take another 5 damage, buddy.
And that's what I hear.
Sarkesh, it's now your turn.
As okay.
The gout of flame kind of pours over you.
This is when I think enough is enough, and I take out my water sack and just pour it in its face.
Alright, it's 5 gallons, right?
Yeah.
And you're pouring all 5 onto it?
Right in its face. Point blank.
Okay. You can hear him hiss and, like, kind of fall back slightly as the water hits him. Ba-bum.
And I'll step back and keep my water container open.
Good. Johan, your turn.
I'm going to make 3 martial arts attacks against it, so burning another key point, flurry of blows. I'll let you know how each one goes.
Look at you rhyming.
That was not the intent, but yeah.
Hit.
Alright.
Okay. Hit.
Okay. I'm going to use that attack, the secondary effect from flurry of blows. It can't take any reactions. Make sure. Until the end of my next turn.
Is it a specific condition, or is that all it says?
Open hand technique. It can't take reactions until the end of your next turn.
Okay.
And third one.
Hits.
Okay. And it needs to make a strength saving throw, still a DC of 12. I'm trying to knock it 15 feet back.
You phase right through it. Hale, that's you. What are you up to? Girl.
Okay, so, I'm going to create water again, but this time I'm not going to do it as rain, and I'm just going to use a first level spell slot. Since I can create it within range of an open container, I don't think it necessarily has to go in said open container. I'm going to drop 10 gallons of straight water on this fire elemental.
Okay.
Because Sarkesh left his container open.
Still there. Oh my god.
Well, Sarkesh's water is already used up, but you use some from a nearby bucket.
Yeah.
And you basically make a cube around it, and then it just splashes onto the ground below, and you can hear it seething.
You want a challenge, Sarkesh? A fair fight?
Perrin, your turn.
I really wish I had more, like, ranged healing spells right now. Alright. Gonna do healing word again on Sarkesh.
Okay, get 4 health back, Sarkesh.
And I guess I'll go back to dodging again. We're focusing on dodging.
Okay.
He hasn't tried to hit me yet, but just in case.
You see the elemental just kind of puff up a little bit, and then again, it attacks both you and, or Johan and Sarkesh. So Johan, it misses. Sarkesh, it hits. There's another 5 for you, buddy. And then after it hits you, it basically moves to be behind you, and new sprouts of flame start coming and moving further into the room. So yeah, that's fun. Sarkesh, your turn.
Before I do anything, I...
Oh wait,
tell
you
it...
didn't put out the fire from last time, so take another 5 damage. And then do whatever you want to do.
I tell it that, fair fight, you lost the right to a fair fight when you attacked an innocent I told to stay out of the fight. He had stopped and you had attacked him. That revoked your rights.
Okay. Now what do you do?
Well, I'm hurting very badly now. I'm just gonna swing my sword at it. Fuck it.
Okay, go for it.
And I'm always missing with my sword.
Apparently you miss with your sword. Alright.
Apparently you can only hit elves.
Apparently.
Someone
proper told... time for a dig, Roger.
I thought so.
It's okay, Sarkesh is
I'm just
gonna
stand back in the corner.
Johan?
I say forget it and call for assistance.
You said it moved further into the room?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take a real quick look around and see what the putting out of the fire situation is looking like.
Well, since it's moved forward, it's getting worse, because now fire is starting to erupt all around you. In fact, Johan, the very ground below you that was dirt is starting to get really, really hot.
Okay. Oh wait, it moved away from me. Do I get an attack of opportunity?
It didn't move out of attack. It moved around you but stayed within 5 feet. It didn't proc attack of opportunity.
Okay, I just... you said Sarkesh and I were on opposite sides of it, so you said it got behind. I thought it got
behind.
Yeah,
it basically
Sarkesh.
Went between you two.
Got it. Is it possible to move to a less flamey, less... likely to burst into flame area and remain in combat with it?
No. Since it bulked up everything within 5 feet of it, within attacking range, or melee attacking range, is a light, essentially.
Okay, Alright, I'm going to disengage and fall back.
Okay. About how far away are you trying to get from it?
Not very far, I'm just trying to get...
It's like 10 feet or so.
Yeah, basically backing up and I'm not getting out of the fight, but mm-hmm. I'm going to work on some more damage control and try and kind of keep it cornered there instead of...
Okay, Hale, what are you doing?
Who else still in the room other than Johan, Sarkesh, the Elemental, me, and Perrin?
There's still soldiers and guards essentially trying to put out the surrounding fire from encroaching any further into the castle.
I'm gonna start trying to get them to evacuate.
Okay, roll persuasion. Yeah. It doesn't seem like they need that much persuasion when the living fire showed up and started just burninating everything. You turn around and you're like, get the hell out of here, we'll handle it. And they're like, okay. And they all leave. Perrin, what would you like to do?
Out of curiosity, what has Lady Roka been doing this entire time? Because if memory serves, she did storm the staircase with us.
She did.
And 40 other witchers.
Yep. They're not in the room with you. They didn't come into the room with you.
But they came up the staircase.
Yeah. Okay. Staircase doesn't stop here. It keeps going. And there was a serpent of fire that continued going up. Presumably they're dealing with that bit.
We can trade if you want.
Well, I guess having heard what Sarkesh said, I guess now would be a time to try to attack it. So we'll go ahead and, so what was the rules for this thing again? Looking at my spear weapon. So I'll make a melee spell attack against a creature. Okay, cool. So we'll go ahead and summon this guy up. And I will stick it on the fire elemental.
Okay, 22 hits.
He does 10 force damage.
Alright. Cool. Anything else you want to do?
And I guess it's my actual action. We will do sacred flame, which does radiant damage.
Okay.
4 damage.
Yeah.
Oh wait, target must succeed on a dexterity saving throw, so you can avoid a DC of 13. Yeah.
So he avoids it. Okay.
Yeah.
I will put the HP back on. Alright. So, it still seems fairly upset. And let's see. It looks like Sarkesh is the only person in range.
Yay, more 5 damage.
So it's going to attack him twice.
15. Yay, missed.
And
I'm dead.
It's all almost right. Like he didn't miss the first time.
So, go ahead and take your 10 damage.
I am dead.
Okay. Sarkesh, you fall to the ground. And as you are falling, you kind of hear a and you hit the ground. Which brings us to your turn. Which, go ahead and take a single death fail and then roll some dice. Roll a d20.
About to say, I've never died before, so this is new.
Alright, you're now at 1-1. One save and one die. And you are still on fire.
So I'm still gonna die before I'm saved.
Not necessarily. You could roll a 20 next turn, and then you would pop back up. Johan, what are you up to?
Is it possible to run over and grab Sarkesh without... because he was within 5 feet, is it possible to grab him without getting in range for an attack so I don't have to disengage to leave?
Yeah, you don't get opportunity of attacks for entering the area. You only get it from exiting the area.
I'd also be exiting. I'm going in. Well,
you have to.
No, you will take damage
with the creature.
No, opportunity attacks, if you move within 5 feet of any creature, they can just go, fuck you, buddy.
Yeah.
Yep. As long as they're not, well, it's irrelevant at this moment. No, you can't do that.
Okay.
Not even if there was a distraction of some sort, could he do it?
Well, there would be no distraction on my turn.
There's no distraction at the moment. Yeah.
It would have to be one of you on your turn.
So, Johan, what are you doing?
I'm going to run in, grab Sarkesh, and jump back out.
Okay. Take 5 damage, and then I'll roll and see if he hits you.
Why do I take 5 damage?
because you entered the area and are immediately set on flame anyways, and then he hits you. Because everything within 5 feet of him is enmassed in fire.
Is Sarkesh... Okay.
Sarkesh is on fire.
Yeah, I know Sarkesh is on fire, but... Okay. So he hits me, so I take 10 damage?
Yes.
Okay.
And where do you move to as soon as you get him out?
Well, I'm using a dash, so I'm...
Getting the fuck out of Dodge?
Getting the fuck out of Dodge. I'm taking him as far down the stairs as I can get him.
Okay. Hale, it is you and Perrin. What are you up to?
And I assume we saw Johan kind of book it?
Actually, hang on, Richard. I'm going to go back.
Okay.
Am I on fire, or did I just take damage for stepping into fire?
You are, I believe, yes, you caught fire.
Okay, then in that case, reverse it. I'm using my last key point to use Step of the Wind to dash, and I'm using my action to try and put out my flame.
Put yourself out, okay.
So, acrobatics, right?
Yes. Well, actually, no, you got all the way out of the room. It doesn't, well, good job. I'll let you do that. You put yourself and Sarkesh out.
Okay.
Essentially, you got out of the room, so it wouldn't have been that hard to put yourself out.
Okay.
Because, like, all things considered, normally, dousing a flame doesn't... It's just an action.
Mm-hmm. We were just doing it while still in the fire.
While still basically in a fire
like
pit.
Like, jumping into a fireplace and trying to put yourself out?
Yeah. Hale, what are you doing?
Well, after seeing Johan book it with Sarkesh, I'm gonna gesture for Perrin to do the same, and I'm gonna follow him out. I don't know what else we can do in here.
Okay. You book it out the door as well. Perrin, what are you doing?
Can I have the weapon attack it again?
Okay, go for it.
So, bonus action...
Hits. Okay, 6 damage.
He attacks me. I could take 2. Okay. I'm gonna stand like at the top of the staircase and just keep an eye on the elemental and see what he does. So I'm using my action to just kind of, or my movement to move near the staircase and then just assume dodge. Yeah.
Okay. You can, as you run out, you turn around kind of just to make sure nothing's following you or to see what's going on. And as you do, you see the living flame bellow out and then condense and bellow out and condense quickly and rapidly. And then it disappears back into the flames itself. Roll perception for me. You can see a slightly denser mass of flame follow the jet up towards the top of the building.
Okay.
And we're back in narrative time, so go ahead and anyone do whatever you want.
Sure.
Like to roll.
Well, actually, first, because Sarkesh would be next. Sarkesh, go ahead and roll your death saving throw. Okay. Perrin? Johan?
Like to run to him and do Spare the Dying.
Okay. You land a Spare the Dying on him.
This is a momentous occasion. Perrin got to use Spare the Dying when someone wasn't dead.
It's glorious, really. You are knocked out for 3 hours, Sarkesh.
Yay.
Yep. But you're not dead.
Hey, guess who didn't fucking die? Twice.
So do I remove the failures? Or...
Yeah, it's all cleared off.
Yeah, as soon as
you're at zero HP,
taking death saving throws, they're all empty. I'm very familiar with this system.
Yes, he is.
I'm not. This is the first time I've been brought down.
Must be nice.
something with a freaking bonus 6 to its roll.
Yeah, it's a pretty high level creature.
Yeah, it turned out probably should not have been fighting the fire elemental.
And as I said, he's the dumbass that decided to challenge it.
Surrounded by
fire. Hey, with great glory comes great story.
I'm just
curious. I was dumb and tried to poke a thing, and then I died. Almost. I was saved afterwards, but that's irrelevant.
So anyways, what are you guys doing? After Perrin reaches down and shocks Sarkesh to stability with radiant glory.
I'm running down to the galley as quickly as I can to grab... they bake bread, so they have to have baking soda. Unless it's all unleavened. Or I guess that's yeast, so, but still.
Or maybe flour.
I'm not looking for flour. I'm specifically looking for baking soda. And if not, salt, but both would be preferable.
Okay. You rush down there. It's going to take you a little while, so what are the rest of you... What are you and Perrin doing, Hale?
Did he rush down there with Sarkesh, or did he just leave
him? No, Sarkesh is unconscious in the staircase.
I'm not carrying an unconscious... He's the only person in the world larger than I am.
So yeah, he wouldn't be able to carry me the whole way down.
I'm carrying him down to the kitchen like, come on, Sarkesh, we're going to do some baking.
I'm worried about the flames spreading out here eventually. It going down. He gets unconscious.
She says to Perrin.
Give him mouth to mouth, you hear echoing through the halls.
Perrin kind of cringes. That kind of elf.
Give him a splinter on top of his near burn to death.
I'm gonna try and take Sarkesh down the stairs and out of the building at least so that he's somewhat safe.
What did you say, Roger?
I'll help her do that too.
Okay. You guys drag Sarkesh down. Johan, you don't know what this baking soda or powder that you're thinking of was, but you found salt.
Okay. I grab as much of it as I can carry and run back up the stairs.
Okay. You find about 2 pounds of salt.
Okay. Is it already, is it in a block form, or is it not?
No, it's essentially, like, koshered out. It's been crushed already.
Good.
It's in a sack. And you're running back up, you notice Sarkesh being dragged by Hale and Perrin down the stairs and into the main area.
Okay. I leave them be.
Okay, you run up, and what do you do?
I begin... coating as much of the flame and gasoline as I can in the salt.
Okay. You just kind of throw it all about as best you can. Mm-hmm. And once you've expended the salt, what do you do?
What's the fire looking like? Because there's no elemental there anymore. Not that I know that, but...
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's still there. It's not furious, especially with the amount of humidity in the room, even though it's lessened because there's a giant hole in the back of the room. The fire is actually kind of dimming down now. It doesn't seem as fervent as it was before.
Okay. Then I'm going to pick up any kind of blanket and just start working my way across, trying to smother it and like create a path backwards.
Back towards the hole? Back out?
Like, towards the back of the room. Like, I'm basically... Okay. I'm gonna get... Yeah.
You don't have much to do that with. You could only get, like, a couple feet.
Oh.
So, I mean, you're pouring 2 pounds of salt. That's not gonna get you very far.
Alright, I guess in that case, I'm just going to... ensure that it doesn't spread back out to where I've smothered it then.
Okay. Go ahead and roll perception for me. And Perrin, you can also roll perception for me. Okay. Perrin, you see a human wearing chainmail with a greatsword and two daggers walking up the staircase, remarkably calm for all of the chaos that's happening outside of the castle. You can see his eyes are just kind of glued to the upper floors, and he walks in and then vanishes from your sight.
Okay.
Johan, you continue to try and put the fire, or keep the fire back about as much as you can.
Okay.
You can hear the clash of swords happening above you now that the roar of the flames has died down a lot.
How difficult is it to keep the flame from spreading back towards me? Like, is it
not
basically...
It's not really...
It's essentially just not fighting its way back over me.
It's not really growing or anything. It's kind of just smoldering.
Okay. Then if there's any dirt left in the area, I'd like to scoop it and kind of create a barrier to the doorway, and then I'm going to head up towards the clashing swords.
Okay. You put up a barrier, bust out through the door, and you start sprinting up the staircase. And you get to the top, and you can see... On the top, what appears to be more of those living flames that you saw before in glorious and horrific battle with the Sisters of the Witchery and some of the guards on one of the towers of the castle. It seems to be like almost like they're condensing the flame and shooting it straight up. And it's amassing about 100 feet in the air above you as the fight continues.
The flames are doing that, or the witchery is doing that to the flame?
The flames are kind of like focusing up like that as the living flames kind of fight around that area.
Where's the nearest... Witcher to me, I suppose.
Only a few feet away as you exit the door. There's a couple that have like severe burns and wounds near you, and then there's more in combat, and you can even see Lady Rocha only maybe 20 feet away from you in fight.
Okay. I turn to anyone who is capable of speech and is not like absurdly busy. What can I do to help?
One of the sisters reaches up to you. Do you have any medical training?
Very little. Standard military.
Help her. And she points to an unconscious sister a few feet away.
Okay. I run over and I'd like to make a medical check.
Okay.
A medicine check.
Go ahead and roll medicine to save her.
You mean murder her, but...
Almost. You do your best to coat all the burns you can, and you can see that there's a pretty deep burn over her throat, and it's actually, even though it's cauterized and it's not bleeding, there's a hole causing air to leak out, so she's not able to breathe, and you cover that and kind of tie a piece of cloth around it to keep her... with you.
Stable. Okay.
And then you feel an odd cold overcome you. And your thoughts immediately kind of change from fighting these, or from saving her, from what you're going to do next. If you're going to fight, or if you're going to start dragging people down, you haven't quite decided what you'd be best at. You're not feeling your best, and you know what these things can do. And your thoughts turn to your parents, and to that night, and everything gets darker, and even all the way down below, Perrin, you remember your village being destroyed. Hale, you remember orcs and giants marauding through your forest, cutting down trees and butchering the friends and family that you had of the forest kin. And Sarkesh, your dreams are tormented by thoughts of your mother. As you look up, or Johan, this for you, go ahead and make a wisdom saving throw.
Okay.
You become trapped, almost incapable of thinking of anything else. Your personal safety, you completely disregard. All you can focus on is that night and what happened and all the pain that they caused and that you caused, and nothing else escapes that. You just find yourself trapped there. Perrin and Hale, you both look up, and you can see the giant gout of flame arcing off in this brilliant orange and white. And then you can feel that deep sorrow pushing in further and further into you, and both of you go ahead and make wisdom saving throws. Perrin, the memories of you are so vivid. It's like you're a child again, coming back and seeing your clan butchered in front of your eyes. Hale, you do your best to fight through your grief, and you focus your attention on the center of it. You look up, and in an instant, you see the pillar of flame, and then it's gone. And you hear a large thrum, and the sound of wind as heat just emanates in a sphere away. It almost burns you. It's so hot as it falls along the entirety of Deadwood. And then there is calm.
But to be clear, the fire's gone.
Mm-hmm. The fire's gone. You kind of stand up slowly, looking around you, and to your left, you can see Perrin clutching nothing, mumbling something. He looks incredibly distraught, almost to the point of tears. You're looking around at the crowd, and all of them are huddled into fetal positions, almost at the edge of desperation. You can notice Sarkesh moving restlessly in his sleep, in his unconsciousness.
I'm going to try to rouse Perrin from whatever trance he's in before going to check things out, I guess.
Okay, how do you try and rouse him?
I'm going to shake him, try to talk to him. Perrin, what's wrong? What's going on? Are you okay? What's happening?
Perrin, how do you respond?
I guess if I'm experiencing things, it'd be like... Orcs are everywhere. No!
And he just continues, just essentially just repeating that over and over again. You can hear the desperate sadness in his voice. Go ahead and make a persuasion check to try and snap him out of it. You try for like 30 seconds and nothing you say can penetrate whatever is taken and bewitched his mind. Johan, you, from the heat and ferocity of battle, feel nothing, and then cold, like the first time you've ever felt cold, kind of just takes you in its entirety, and you sit there thinking and fighting with yourself, and then you feel a hand clasp your shoulder and then put something in your hand, and you hear a voice say, "Eat this. It'll help, brother." And then you can hear footsteps fading away as you do that, and slowly your senses start to come back as the kind of warm chocolate goes down your throat, and it's a very odd feeling of warmth that begins to flow throughout your body. You begin to take stock of everything around you, and you see the sisters, those who aren't broken by battle, seem to be fighting with the same demons that you were in your head, all around you. The fire is all but gone. Only a few small lingering flames remain on the roof, and they are quickly being put out just by the wind.
Am I myself again? I've regained my composure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You've slowly regained your composure.
Okay. Of those of the witchery who are dealing with stuff, are there any who seem like kind of on the edge of, or who seem like the most cogent? Like, can I tell any of them who are not like completely far gone?
Yeah, there's some that you've never met before that seem reasonably cogent. They still seem like they're dealing with stuff, but that they're getting through it faster than the others.
Okay, I'm going to run over to the nearest of them that I can and attempt to snap them out of it. You know, a gentle shake and like guiding words, essentially.
All right, go ahead and roll persuasion.
Okay.
Yeah, you put your hand clasp her shoulder. And as you turn, you realize you've seen this one before. You believe her name was Alana or Elena. You try and guide her back. You try and convince her that everything that's going on is in her head, that it'll be okay. And after about half a minute, you calm her down well enough that she has gotten her wits back together.
Is she the one who we met outside the gate
mm-hmm.
when we entered Deadwood? Okay. Wasn't sure. Sorry, I just wanted to make sure I added that to my notes. Ma'am, I need you to snap out of it. I guess they're men and women, so... your companions in combat are suffering, and they need your help. Help me rouse everyone you can.
She looks around and then kind of just knowingly nods to you and gets up slowly, steadies herself, and then makes her way to one of the nearby sisters and begins trying to calm them down.
Try waking someone with medical expertise. Some of them are in need of help.
She nods.
I'm going to work my way over to Rocha.
Okay. She seems very, very far gone. She is on the ground, just sobbing brutally.
I just begin shouting her name as loudly as I can and attempting to rouse her.
Okay, roll intimidation.
Okay. I have that trained. And still not as good as my persuasion.
yeah, you scream at her and it doesn't seem like it can get through. Whatever she's dealing with is far too deep. You hear her talking about losing losing all of them. They're never going to come back, and it's all her fault. It was her responsibility to take care of them. She was a damned fool.
Can I pin her to the ground?
Yes, if you wanted to, yeah.
Okay. I'm going to pin her and remove my trophy dagger from my sack and give her a small cut on the shoulder.
Okay.
All while still shouting her name.
Okay, go ahead and roll intimidation.
Actually, she has her armor on, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Is there an area of bare flesh that I could give her a flesh wound?
Well, she wears plate mail, so not really. You'd have to move some of it.
Okay, then yeah, I remove a gauntlet as best I can.
Okay. And give her a snick across the wrist or something, or hand?
Yes, forearm, hand, whatever.
Okay. Go ahead and roll intimidation again.
Okay.
Alright. With that, she slowly kind of starts getting back. You can tell that she's still very far out of it, but she's starting to regain her kind of normal composure very slowly, and over the course of a minute, she does calm down.
Okay. Rocha, your subordinates need you.
Yes. Yes, of course. Thank you. And she wipes away her tears and gets up and begins...
I put my dagger away and present her gauntlet.
She takes it and kind of like wanders for a second and then realizes what's going on, puts her gauntlet on and begins trying to get some of the others up.
Okay. And I'm just going to repeat the cycle. Yeah. I just need someone to help in her.
Okay. So yeah, the rest of the... You begin getting the rest of the witchers up.
Okay.
Hale, after a few minutes of dealing with Perrin, of trying to figure out what's going on, you see a man walk out, a human man, wearing very dark leather armor underneath, kind of burnt chainmail, or like fire-blackened chainmail. Who's wielding a very large greatsword and two daggers. He kind of slowly walks out of the palace, sees you, and then walks over and says, "You need to help all of them."
What can I do to help?
Shake them out of it. Get water. Food. Something to get their minds off of it. And then, with that, he stands up and just walks away.
Okay, I'm gonna go gather as much water and food as I can find and start trying to rouse people. I'll come back to Perrin later.
Okay. Over the course of the next hour or so, you guys manage to rouse all of the witchers who... immediately go about helping the soldiers and other witchers who were wounded there, taking them to medical areas and such, and eventually recover everyone, or get everyone back to normal. And you all kind of come to gather at the bottom steps of the palace.
Is everyone all right?
About as alright as we get.
We'll say it's... Yeah, you wake up. You've woken up.
Okay, I'm using Lay on Hands.
Okay. You now have 5 HPs. If you use all of it.
Yeah, I'm using all of it. Stabilize myself as much as possible. Okay, I'm apologizing to the group for my actions, and then I'm going to find Lady Rocha.
Okay.
Didn't she come down with me?
No, she's dealing with all the witchers and stuff. Once they were all pretty much settled and able to take care of themselves, you headed down to see if there was anyone else that needed your help.
Got it.
I'm going to mention to Johan about the strange man that I saw who told me to help the townspeople. And say that he came from within the castle. Ask him if maybe he thinks that he had anything to do with this.
Can you describe the man?
He was carrying a large sword, two daggers, black leather armor, I think, and his armor over it was stained with... It was stained black from the flames. Which means he had to have been in one of the areas that was being attacked.
Does that sound anything like anyone Johan could have possibly seen?
Go ahead and roll intelligence.
Nat 1.
Nat yes! 1! Nah, you never heard of this person before.
Way to call it!
I say Nat 1 for everyone.
I know.
It's just usually under my breath. But I had a Nat 20 two rolls ago, so... It was coming.
Yeah, no, you don't recall it at all.
Okay.
This doesn't sound that familiar to you. Could be anyone.
Did I see what direction the man left in? I'm pretty sure I did, but...
Yeah, he was basically heading towards the front of town, or all right, the exit.
I'm gonna head in the direction that he went and inform Johan that, okay, you didn't see him, watched him head that way, I'm gonna go start looking for him, see what I can figure out about what happened.
Alright, well, be careful, we don't know what all is still going on outside the castle walls.
I know, I'll be alright. And with that, I leave to go follow the man, or try to follow the man.
Okay. So... Johan, what are you up to?
Alright, so Sarkesh is up, used to lay on hands on himself, and then left to go right back where I came from.
Mm-hmm, after apologizing.
Mm-hmm. And... I assume Perrin has pulled himself out of it at this point?
Yes.
Okay.
By the time you got down, Perrin had pulled himself out.
Yeah. What does the city look like?
Besides obvious signs of, like, panic, it looks fine for the most part. None of it was touched by the flame.
Okay. So, doesn't, as far as I can tell, no attacks on the city. And what kind of panic would you say in the city, because it's been like an hour and a half since the attack, right?
I know, but there's still like the food stands and stuff that were knocked over. There's still stuff to be cleaned up. It was
okay,
obvious that
meant,
there was
like people aren't still running through the streets screaming an hour and a half later.
No,
okay.
It just looks like there was a panic there, and
okay,
people haven't really gone outside to clean
it
anything
looks
up
like
yet.
A bomb went off at the palace.
Yeah, that and no one decided to leave their houses to start cleaning up yet, because fuck that.
Are there any, is there anyone lingering, or is it just guards and soldiers?
Well, pretty much all the civilians outside are still outside until they get, like, the all clear, essentially. So Maester Judic and a bunch of the other people are out there. A lot of nobles are out there as well.
Alright, I guess I'll go speak to, Maester Judic.
Okay. Oh, Johan! Good to see that you're well. Thank goodness.
And how are you?
Fine.
Were you near the explosion that happened?
No, I was in my quarters on the bottom. Quite far, thankfully.
Have you spoken to anyone who, came out of the castle who might have seen what happened?
No, I spoke to one of the mages, and they said it was just an eruption, that something was left for the High Mage, and then there was just white flame.
I see. My companion Hale made mention of a strange man exiting the castle during the commotion. And I give a rough, I assume my description is a bit like playing telephone, so, mm-hmm. but I give the best I can.
You can, he says, no, I've no idea who that might be.
At the risk of yet another one, can I roll insight on that?
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, a six.
Ho-ho! You can... You're not sure if he's just very shaken, but he doesn't sound quite like himself.
Okay. Well, Mr. Judic, I appreciate your help. I beg of you, if you get any further information on this man, please send for me.
He nods and thanks you for your help with the castle, and insists that he must get back to tending to the lords and other nobles.
Of course.
And bids you adieu. Perrin, what are you up to?
Some people need attending to, so I'm gonna try to help people.
I mean, all you can do is spare the dying, because you're, like, super negative in all your spells.
I actually can still do...
You had... You had, one spell when all of this started, and I let you cast, like, four.
One Remember spell? He said at the,
Because you did the hospital.
You go through all except for one every day?
Yeah.
And then you used it in the fight? In the tournament? And then I think you used four in combat against the Fire Elemental.
Well, the ones I used at the tournament are
cantrips.
Channeled divinities.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They're all things that you can do for free, pretty much.
Okay. But I know you used Healing Words, which is at least your last one.
Yeah.
So right. you can spare any of the dying people, which there are a lot of people who are pretty severely injured still. So you go around and you start doing that. You can also roll Medicaid and try and help people that way as well.
We spent too long playing Dark Heresy.
Just go around and spare the dying.
Okay.
It does the same thing and I can guarantee it works.
Yep. Alright, you go around. Let's see, Sirkesh, you were gonna go and seek out the lady?
Yes.
Alright, you find her, kind of getting everyone together, organizing... basically stretcher teams to start shoveling the heavily wounded away to the any of the hospitals and back to the witchery.
I try and pull her to the side and I tell her I need to talk to her immediately.
Yes? What do you need?
I know this is hard to say. I haven't seen an elemental like that since before I left Necross. I was hoping you had any information on those creatures.
I've never come across them personally. I've never seen anything like fire that has a mind of its own. But perhaps our library has some. I feel this is old magic. Either the college or the maesters would know more.
All right. Thank you for your time.
She nods and then gets back to commanding, leading.
And I limp off to try and find some of the mages.
Okay. Hale, you get all the way to the front gate. Where you come across three witchers standing guard.
I'm going to ask them if they've seen the man, and I'm going to relay the description to them.
They look about at each other, kind of anxiously, and then, no, we haven't seen anyone by that description. Why?
Because he came out of the burning building. He was the only one that seemed unscathed by everything going on, for the most part.
That's quite strange. We'll, put out a search for him once everything's calmed down.
And I roll inside on that.
Okay. Oh yeah, they're lying to you.
I don't believe you. I think you're lying to me. Where is he?
We haven't seen him.
Subtlety.
Well, not very subtle, so.
All that charm, none of it went to subtlety.
Look
Can
at my tits!
Can I try to persuade them to let me see him?
How are you going to try and persuade them?
With persuasion.
Okay, but like, actually. What is your argument that you're putting forward, essentially?
I would like to meet the man who asked for me to help the others so that I can at least thank him for giving me the advice on getting them food and water. Maybe figure out what he knows about what happened.
Okay, roll persuasion. They seem pretty adamant about not letting on that they know anything. They insist they've not seen the man. If they do, they will detain him for questioning by the witchery and the palace.
Okay. I'm going to walk away to where they can't see me and contemplate on what to do because I don't know yet.
Okay. So, with that, it has been our allotted time. So it's up to you guys if you want to continue at any amount of time or catch back up with that in 2 weeks.
I thought we'd catch up in 2 weeks.
Alright.
Okay.
I'm good with that.
Sounds good. Everyone, go ahead and give yourself 650 experiences.
I get the level.
For almost defeating a fire elemental. Almost. And by almost, I mean you got like halfway there. Good job.
Almost half.
No, you got past half.
Did we?
Mm-hmm.
I thought they had 100 plus or so, and I thought we only did.